Welcome to the 16th meeting in 2023 of the Delegated Powers and Law Reform Committee. I'd like to remind everyone present to switch their mobile phones to silent. And apologies have been received from Oliver Mundell, MSP. The first item of business is to decide whether to take items 6 and 7 in private. Is the committee content to take these items in private?
Yes.
Under agenda item number 2, we're considering an instrument subject to the affirmative procedure. No points have been raised on the draft Social Security Residence Requirements, Sudan, Scotland, Regulations 2023. Is the committee content with this instrument?
Yes.
Under agenda item number 3, we're considering an instrument subject to the negative procedure. No points have been raised on SSI 2023-141. Is the committee content with this instrument? Under agenda item number 4, we are considering an instrument which is not subject to any parliamentary procedure. No points have been raised on SSI 2023-139. Is the committee content with this instrument?
Yes.
Okay, moving to agenda item number 5 today, we are taking evidence on the Trusts and Succession Scotland Bill. So, first of all, I'd like to open up to Jeremy Balfour.
Thank you. Just for the avoidance of doubt, John MacArthur, one of the witnesses, is a personal friend of mine. I, many years ago, was a trainee with Anderson's Treherne, and Alan Barr, in the second panel, was one of my lecturers at university.
OK, thank you, Jeremy. So, for our first panel, can I welcome Ross Anderson, a partner at Jones White, Sandy Lamb, a partner at Lindsay's, John MacArthur, a partner at Gillespie McAndrew, Caroline Pringle, a director at Anderson Strathairn, and Joseph Slane, an associate at Turkin Connell. And a note that Mercedes Vialba MSP is joining us online. So first of all, can I remind the panel not to worry about turning on the microphones during the session, as these are controlled by broadcasting. And if you would like to come in on any question, please just raise your hand or indicate to the clerks to do so. And that there is no need to answer every question, simply indicate that this is not for you to respond. However, please feel free to follow up in writing to any question after the meeting, if you wish. So we'll now move to the questions. So I'll open today. So on the 2nd of May, the Scottish Law Commission said to the committee that it's very important that trust law reforms ultimately apply to pension trusts as well. And this, the current plan is for this to have effect through a Section 104 order agreed between both Scottish and UK governments. Do you share the view that this bill that should apply to pension trusts in whole or in part? And what would the practical impact be for you if there was a gap between the legislation coming into force for most trusts and then the legislation coming into force separately for pension trusts?
My issue is that I actually don't deal with pension trusts very often, so I can't really add any comment to that, I'm afraid.
Okay.
I would say the same, and I would simply observe that if you had different regimes applying to different types of trusts, it could lead to a degree of confusion, but that's not coming from a position of any particular authority on pension trusts.
I would simply echo my colleague's statements here that we don't deal with pension trusts, so it's not something I can speak to.
Okay.
I'm sorry, I'm exactly the same position. I've done a little bit, but not a huge amount of work with pension trusts, but I just on observation, I would have similar concerns about having sort of two different regimes working in parallel and whether there would be any lacuna in the middle that could cause issues going forward.
And I would reiterate the rest here as well. Pension trusts are not an area which I have experience or practice in. My comments would just be to reiterate what Caroline and Sandy had said there about having two different regimes at the same time. But okay. Again, that doesn't come from a position of experience or practice.
Okay. So we did hear last week just in evidence, not saying also what you've said, but we did hear that that it's quite common for different regimes to apply in law anyway. So it wouldn't, although it's beneficial, and I think people certainly want to have the Section 104 order passed as quickly as possible, so that it's the one regime that's been utilised. But we did hear last week that it wouldn't be a deal breaker. It wouldn't be overly complicated if there was two different systems in operation.
I think as long as it's well known and there's no surprises, then that would be fine.
No.
But ideally, just one system would be, I think, better.
Okay. Fair enough, thank you. I'm going to hand over to Jeremy.
Thank you. Good morning. Thank you all for coming this morning. The bill has some new powers for the Shire of Court, but the Court of Session remains the main court for trusts under the bill. Do you think we've got the balance about right, or do you think more should be done or be allowed to be done within the Shire of Court rather than coming to the Court of Session?
Is around cost and the cost that it would that leads to going to the Court of Session. You know, we're trying to make this more accessible. I mean, obviously, there needs to be have judicial oversight over things because these are quite significant powers that you are giving the court. And I think the concern is whether a better balance could be struck so that it's not at the cost of the trust funds, which the expenses would be met from.
Just before anyone, can I just see where would the expenses then, or where would you see the expenses
coming
from? No,
I think they could come from, I think they should come from the trust fund, but I'm just saying if we're always having to resort to the Court of Session on matters, that comes with more cost in general than a sheriff court.
My position on the matter is that there are powers which are reserved to the courts, which should be delegated to the trustees of the trust in relation to particularly removing trustees. I feel that our legislation could be more aligned to the English position, which grants greater powers to the co-trustees in terms of appointing and removing trustees. So that would be my comment on that, that I agree with Caroline, applications should be on a greater extent made to the Sheriff Court, but from my point of view, there should be a greater tendency to allow the trustees and the truster to make certain decisions rather than having to rely on the court making that decision.
I would, if I may, without any criticism implied or overt of the Sheriff Court, the Court of Session does have a degree more experience and perhaps knowledge in relation to complicated trust matters. So I don't necessarily have too much of a difficulty with certain things being reserved to the Court of Session. I would broadly agree with the notion that it should be accessible, and that the costs should not be insupportable, particularly for smaller trust funds. I'm not involved in a great deal of litigation, but I understand there is often not a huge amount of difference between costs from court to court, depending on what one is doing, depending on who, whether it is opposed or not.
If I can add to that, I think choice is important. So the trustees will know the basis of litigation they're about to embark on, and if they can have the choice between the Court of Session or the Sheriff Court, depending on how complicated it is, then that allows a sort of accessibility, but also accessibility knowing that you're going to court, a court with the knowledge that it requires to decide on those questions that are being asked.
I want to just quickly follow up a point made by Mr. Lamb, and that is in regard to the cost comparative between Sheriff Court and Court of Session. The evidence we've taken previously is that there is not much of a differential now between most courts. Is that your experience?
As I say, I'm not involved in a great deal of litigation, so it's mostly from discussion with my colleagues in the court department.
Okay, we can maybe move on, if that's okay. Looking at really section 12 and section 7 of the bill, a trustee does not get to participate in trust decisions under section 12 when they are incapable. Trustees can also be removed as fellow trustees from their role under section 7 on again the basis that the trustee is incapable. I'm just wondering, do you think we've got this balance about right? Are you happy that the definitions are up to date enough, and what reflections do you have on if we could do it differently, how would we do it differently?
I have some concerns about the ability for trustees to remove one of their own number extrajudicially on the basis of one of the trustees being incapable. And the reason for that is based on the inherent subjective element that comes with assessing capacity. Capacity is a spectrum. An individual might have capacity for one act and not another. It's something that we as solicitors and medical professionals deal with on a regular basis, but nevertheless can sometimes find difficult. I think putting the onus on trustees who may not be as used to making assessments like that could be difficult and create problems and potentially create issues for the trustee who is being removed.
Where a client is particularly elderly and potentially loses capacity, and at the moment that can involve litigation, a court exercise, court application to remove the trustee, whereas I feel that with the correct legal advice and a solicitor of adequate experience assessing capacity, the trustees being able to make that decision is advantageous.
I think I'll pick up on one point that Ross is the... it's the ability of the trustees to get that evidence, because necessarily the evidence is personal to the individual trustee concerned. And the trustees, I think, are at a disadvantage. I mean, there is one Section 47, I think, the Adult Incapacity Act allows a doctor to sign a certificate allowing a treatment, and I just wonder if we could extend that slightly so that that certificate could be used by the trustees when they're analysing or assessing the capacity of their fellow trustee. I think... also, sorry, Sandy, if we could turn it around slightly. You asked Ms. Balfour if we could have other suggestions. And I think one thing I think is missing here is the ability of the incapable trustee's guardian and power of attorney to sign a minute of resignation. So that actually takes the pressure off the trustees and allows the representatives of the incapable trustee to actually make that decision. I think that would be a lot easier.
Yeah. I was merely going to observe that in terms of the test for incapacity contained in Section 75, it seems to me to be a pretty direct version of what one finds in the Adults with Incapacity Act, which of course has been with us for 23 years, and I think most would agree has operated fairly reasonably. If the idea is to align this particular question of what incapacity is with existing law, then I think that's probably to be welcomed. Of course, if there is to be reform to the Adults with Incapacity Act, would there then be reform to any Trusts and Succession Scotland Act that follows from these deliberations?
Well, I mean, I'll just maybe tee up on that, because the panel last week from academics was suggesting, rather than putting the exact wording in, to refer it back to the Act. So if there was a change in the Act or think of that, that we just then immediately change the definition within this. Is that a workable solution in practice rather than an academic view?
Well, I don't see why not. And as with many things, our academics are, of course, ahead of us.
But just in practice, that would work for you on a day-to-day basis.
I see no difficulty with it.
If the legislation is linked to another definition, another act which could change, then it makes sense to link it to that other act, and then as it evolves, the Trust Act will evolve with it without an additional requirement to amend the Trust Act.
Okay. Thank you, Commissioner.
Okay, thank you, Mercedes Villalba.
I'd like to thank you, Convener. I think my mic's on now. I'd like to move us on to sections 16 and 17 of the bill, which look at trustees' powers of investment. Perhaps we could, I think the question will be to the whole panel, so perhaps we could start with Ross and work our way around. So the Law Society, as well as the academic Yvonne Evans, have suggested that in view of Scotland's increasing emphasis on net zero goals, that section 16 and 17 could be amended to allow trusts to adopt environmentally friendly investment policies, particularly when these might underperform compared to other investments. So the committee is interested to hear the panel's views on this policy idea and if you do support it in principle, whether you think the drafting of section 16 and 17 would need to be tweaked or amended to make it clear to trustees that they do have the power to make those investments, even when they might underperform compared to other investments.
Okay. I think from a public policy point of view, I can see the merit in that. However, in real life practice, when you're representing trustees who have to endeavour to look after the best interests of the beneficiaries, if a beneficiary sees that an investment is underperforming and the trustees have made that decision on the basis of public policy, I can imagine as a solicitor in practice, the feedback I would get from those beneficiaries. So I think on the balance, I don't think that I would personally support that position. If it were to come into effect, though, do I think the wording of that clause is acceptable? I think potentially that would have to be altered to make it clear that the trustees were acting in line with public policy and that that had been accounted for in statute.
Thank you.
Yes, I don't disagree with Ross. I would say that the current way that the section 16 is drawn does state that trustees have the power to make any kind of investment of trust property, except insofar as the trustee expressly or implication provides otherwise. Perhaps it ought to be left to the trustor, the settlor of the trust, to determine whether there ought to be any particular restrictions on investment or particular classes of investments that are more suitable. That would certainly get around any difficulties that the trustees might experience with beneficiaries suggesting that what they've done has pauperised them or disadvantaged them to whatever degree. And there's also, admittedly, the ability to later on, section 17, to take proper advice, and if that includes from those skilled in investment in greener areas, should we say renewables, your sort of ESG stuff, then I dare say that could be part of that advice to the trustees, which they may well then be able to rely on.
Just picking up on Sandy's point, I think when you're looking at investment powers, is the truster who's put this money in trust, apart from an existing trust, but going forward, I think carbon's a big issue, and I think on balance, I'd prefer if the trust it was left to the truster to decide in giving the powers to the trustees. Perhaps with one exception, that is where the trustees could agree with beneficiaries who are of age and can give that agreement. They may agree on investment policy, which is not for maximising growth from the portfolio. It may be more aligned to sort of greener issues, as it were. But at the moment, carbon and carbon investment is actually quite high risk from what I'm hearing. I'm not an investment manager, so I can't comment beyond that. But to go into carbon and carbon investment is high risk at the moment. And therefore, trustees do put themselves at risk of a claim if those investments don't perform or fail.
And with the bill as drafted, do you feel that it allows trustees to make those investments, or does it need to be amended to make it clearer that that is an option that's open to them?
I think it needs to be amended to make it absolutely clear. Because if I was advising a trustee on the basis of this section, I'd be saying, look, there's a risk that you leave yourself open to a claim by disappointed beneficiaries at some point in the future.
And do you have a view on how that amendment should look, or what specifically would need to be said to give you that reassurance
well,
when you're advising?
It does allow a sort of wide spectrum of investments, but I think it would be easier to give advice if the Act specifically, or the section specifically, allowed investments in assets which may not perform in line with other asset classes that are invested in.
Okay, thank you very much.
Yes, I agree with all the comments that I've said previously. I think in practice, the trustees have obligations to the beneficiary, to advise the trustees to ensure that they're not breaching their fiduciary duties and their duties to the beneficiaries of the trust to get the best return for them. And I think as currently drafted, I would have concerns about advising trustees to go down that path and without anything more specific or set. And I like the idea of it being a case-by-case basis where some sort of thought is given to the rights of the trustor and what they want and what they envisaged for how the fund was invested. And I think we maybe need to look and revisit how the power of investment is exercised in the clause, because I think the powers as drawn under Section 16 are quite broad. It gives you broad, flexible powers. But in terms of the exercise of those powers, it's saying, you know, in terms of suitability, you're looking at not just financial performance, you're looking at sort of a broader public policy and giving greater protection to the trustees if they decide to go down that route, which comes with higher risk.
And so even if we could still, is it still possible to allow it to be taken on a case-by-case basis, but still have some clarification in the bill that it is an option for those people that are interested, or those trustees that are interested?
I think it would be helpful to have something in the legislation to provide additional protection and reassurance so that because trustees are already putting themselves in a position where they are subject to, as it should be, they are accountable to the beneficiaries. And I think this will allow them a bit greater sort of discretion to think about investment policies and what they should and shouldn't invest in, and give them more freedom in that respect and think about what they actually believe in and what would be right in terms of investment. So I think it would be helpful to have that in there, that, you know, they're not going to be prejudiced as a result of following a line of investment on the basis of public policy grounds, or their own personal, or the trustor's personal preferences.
Thank you.
Yeah, I would just agree with everything that's been said already, really. I do think it could be a bit clearer in the legislation itself if that kind of investment route is to be permitted. In the absence of anything expressly provided for in the trust deed that favours that or otherwise, where that might slot in, I think maybe Section 17, where it talks about the exercise of the power of investment and the matters that trustees are to have regard to under 17A, 1 to 2, talks about the suitability, the need for diversification. I think that might be an appropriate place to at least begin to consider other types of investment. But that's just a suggestion. There may be scope within Section 16 as well, but it's one for the drafters to consider. But I think, as John said, I think it would be better to put it beyond the avoidance of doubt, because I too would look at the legislation as it is currently provided and be hesitant to advise on that basis.
Okay. Brilliant. Thank you very much. I'll hand back over to the...
Okay, thank you. Jeremy, you wanted to come in.
I wonder if I could just develop this slightly in regard to, is there enough clarity for trustees? So if you're a charity who has an asset that you want to give to another charity, the general view is yours had to get best value for that sale. But if you're passing on to another charitable, which has got similar charitable basis, you might want to sell it to them for a cheaper price. Does that need clarity within this, or is there enough clarity already to give trustees room to do that? I say that when I worked for a charity, previously we were talking to another charity, we were asking if they could sell it to us at a discount price so we could use it for charitable purposes, but they came back and said, no, we've got to get the best price for our beneficiaries. I'm just wondering, is there clarity that could be sought around that, where we're benefiting another trust?
I think we're in danger of mixing up charity law and trust law here. You know, at one level, I can see arguments for charities agreeing to sell at an undervalue because, you know, it's going to another charity. In pure trust law, if you're acting for a trustee in a private trust, you're saying, oh, actually, I've got to get fair value here for the benefit of my beneficiaries. So I'm just slightly concerned that if we go down the route of what you're suggesting, Mr. Balfour, we have a an issue just between charity law and trust law?
I think if you were going to go down that route, you would have to make that expressly clear in the legislation that that exemption would apply. I don't think the legislation is clear on that point at all.
So it would require a further amendment to, if we wanted to do that?
I believe so.
Okay.
Me, so I apologise, I don't have it. It's looking at the Charities and Trustee Investments Scotland Act as well and how they interact with each other.
Yeah.
Okay. Okay, yeah,
okay. Thank you. We'll move to section 19. Section 19 says that unless a trusted, it says otherwise, trustees could use a nominee in respect of any of the trustees' powers, and a nominee is someone to whom a trustee transfers ownership of trust property, often for investment purposes. Now, the law firm CMS is concerned that Section 19 of the Bill on Nominees is currently drafted. It may not go far enough in capturing the ways in which trusts are used in the financial services sector. Specifically, the firm has said that doubt would remain as to whether trustees can use A, nominee custody structures, and B, sub-custodians. Do panel members have any views on this, both on the current scope of Section 19 and the risks identified by CMS?
I think one of the issues with Section 19, particularly 1A, is it says appoint a person. Now, I did check and I couldn't see, but a person to me sounds like an individual rather than a corporate. And I think with commercial trusts or the likes of what CMS are talking about, they tend to use corporate nominees. So I'd be concerned that the definition of person should be extended so that it covers both an individual but also a corporate, possibly LLP. It's not an area I specialise in, the sort of corporate area of how investments are managed. But you know, I think that has to be widened to allow to address that concern. It certainly replicates a concern I have about the section as it's drafted.
Okay.
I would agree with John, and I'd say I've just looked at the interpretation section in 74, which doesn't include person as a defined term. So.
Okay. Just other panelists, any comments? Okay. Ross.
CMS's point, to be honest with you, but in respect of section 19, I think there has been historically under the 21 Act a great debate around the power of nominees and granting powers to others to act on behalf of trustees. And I would simply want the committee's attention to be drawn to the English position under the Trustee Act of 1925, which grants the trustees the ability to grant greater powers to another person in respect of the management of the trust. And I personally have found that to be helpful in the past when dealing with those types of trusts, whereas this clearly grants powers always under the supervision of the original trustees. And my preference would be that the power to grant authority to another person or corporate entity would extend to allow that person to use autonomy in respect of managing the trust. But that is just my personal opinion on the matter.
Okay. Next, John.
One more point, and that is it talks about the exercise of their powers. And in trustees, we talk about administrative powers and dispositive powers or discretionary powers. And I think the point of nominees is really to do with the administration of the trust, not making decisions about where the trust ends up or how it's invested. It's the route through which investments can be managed. For example, land can be held. Therefore, I do wonder whether it should perhaps be restricted to administrative powers only, as opposed to dispositive or fiduciary powers, exercise of fiduciary powers. But
which sort of replicates the common position that you cannot delegate your discretionary functions as a trustee.
Okay. Joseph?
I think with regard to the delegation of powers generally, it's linked, 19 is necessarily linked with 18 as well, and delegation and appointment of agents. I'm coming back to the distinction between dispositive and administrative powers. I do think that 18 deals with that to some degree, and subsection 5 talks about what may or may not be delegated. 19 deals more with the specific scenario of nominees. And for that basis, I don't know if there really needs to be additional distinction drawn between dispositive and administrative powers in that section as well, as John suggested.
Okay, thank you. And Bill Kidd.
Thanks very much, convener. Thanks, everyone. Sections 25 and 26 of the bill. Section 25 requires trustees first to tell a beneficiary that they are a beneficiary, and second, to give them all the trustees' names and correspondence details. And this is a mandatory element for certain types of beneficiary. For potential beneficiaries, trustees have some discretion as to what information is provided under Section 25. And then in Section 26, it's about what information must be made available to beneficiaries and potentials. But the trust deed can override Section 26, though a court can later review the reasonableness of that override. So there's quite a degree of to-ing and fro-ing there, to put a wee point on it. So various respondents to the committee's calls for views have said that trustees' duties to provide information to beneficiaries and potential beneficiaries under Section 25-26 are too onerous. There's too many elements to have to take into account. Do you have concerns about how, and if you have, how would you think about amending these two sections to address those concerns?
My concern is that it's quite woolly as currently drafted, and I think that's done for a reason, because there needs to be a level of flexibility to the rules. But from just my practice, I mean, the majority of trusts that we're setting up currently tend to be discretionary trusts, and I completely understand that there needs to be a level of accountability to beneficiaries and transparency. But at the same time, when you have a very broad class of potential beneficiaries, it's where do you draw that line as to your obligations to account to them? And, you know, further reading of it, I can come to different interpretations, and a lot of it's down to the trustee's discretion. But I think that could potentially cause problems further down the line, where it is really just left at the trustee's discretion as to what their obligations are. Meaning there could be vast differences in practice, and us ultimately then having to go to the court for clarity at a later point anyway.
Okay. I can see Joseph's got something to say there, actually.
No, I agree. Yeah, I think it is slightly... The drafting is a little bit woolly there.
Aye.
And following on from what Caroline mentioned, what the impact would be if it came down to a court decision to decide that a decision to not disclose certain information was made, what impact that would have for the trustees generally in their position? Would they be in breach of trust? Would that be a breach of trust sufficient enough to merit removal? I think it's just a little bit, given the wide discretion that's afforded to trustees by virtue of this, it leaves them in a bit of a slightly grey area.
Right. Can I just say something? Thanks. Just on the back of that then, because I do understand exactly what you're talking about, and I see how that provides a bit of clarity with these two sections, but is there not a wee bit of a potential issue for the beneficiaries and potential beneficiaries in terms of the trustees having too much power to decide how they might, you know, they might decide how to go forward, and the beneficiary who is supposed to benefit from this might not actually get as much out of it as they might otherwise? Yes, Sandy.
There's always a balance. That's core to the advice that we give, I think, to trustees and indeed to beneficiaries. I personally think that the terms of Section 25 and 26 are, I think it's sensible to be fairly woolly on it, because, as Caroline says, there are a number of discretionary trusts where there may be a vast array of beneficiaries, some of whom might not ever have really been intended to be beneficiaries, and a lot will be informed by the settlor's letter of wishes, which any sensibly drafted trust will have as a sort of backup. That being so, and given that the terms of the letter of wishes are expressly excluded from what is to be
provided under, I think, Section 26.
Yeah.
The trustees are, although arguably it is an onerous duty, but being a trustee is an onerous duty anyway. And my observation would be that despite, you know, not dealing with sort of tax all the time, trust taxation now requires often registration with the HMRC's Trust mm-hmm. Registration Service, mm-hmm. which requires one to gather information on beneficiaries anyway. So given that a trustee or those acting for a trustee will probably be doing this monitoring and potentially holding that on file for these purposes anyway, mm-hmm. arguably it's not a huge extra onerous duty. Although I would echo what was mentioned earlier on. If we're going to be providing the court with the ability to remove trustees where they've neglected the trustees' duties mm-hmm. or is purported to carry out the duties but does so in a way inconsistent with or might be inconsistent with the trustees' fiduciary duty, then clearly not providing information is grounds for removal.
Mm. Okay, no, that makes sense. It's just, in Section 26, trustee can in fact override the actual a trustee can override Section 26, but then a court can later review the reasonableness of that override. So that tends to be looking into whether people are being unreasonable in the manner in which they behave, I suppose, towards the beneficiary.
So for the trustee to override, that would require the truster to have specified, and one would hope that the truster would have a good reason for that. Aye. Again, perhaps explained in the letter of wishes.
Yeah. I think it's important to remember that the truster appoints the trustees because he clearly he trusts them to manage the assets on behalf of the appointed beneficiaries. And there's always a balance to be had between the different powers and responsibilities, and it actually depends which side of the camp you're on. Mm-hmm. So if you're advising a beneficiary and you're not getting enough information, then you want as much ability to ask for that as possible. Yeah. The trustees will know the wider picture in regard of the whole trust, or at least they should do, and therefore they may have a slightly different judgment to be made. Mm-hmm. So I think willingness here is probably better than being more prescriptive. And bearing in mind the truster appointed the trustees, the balance slightly in favour of the trustees is probably better as well. Mm. Given that if there's failure to perform their duties to invest wisely, whatever else, then that's a kind of slightly different route that you would take to challenge the trustees. And you might be looking for the removal, for example, or claim for loss of expected inheritance. And there's different routes to go down for that. Mm. So I think on balance, having the balance in favour of the trustees is better given the context in which the trust is written.
Okay, that makes sense. Thank you very much. Can I move on from there?
Sure.
Okay, right. Thank you. That covered just about everything there, I think, actually. It's in terms of Section 49.3a about domicile. We had Professor Paisley from Aberdeen University speaking to us about this, and he had a few issues. He said that it would be harder to get information about who controls land or property if a trust was later treated as being resident overseas. And in its written submission to the committee, the Law Society didn't comment on the policy underpinning Section 49, but it did say that it thought the drafting of the domicile subsection was unclear in terms of its scope, and also that the scope of the separate power of the protector to determine the trust's administrative centre was also unclear. So I can ask, do you have any, do you agree with academics' interpretation of Section 49? Do you have views on whether protectors should have the power in looking at overseas domicile for trusts in order to sort of challenge issues?
My only point, and it's not slightly answering your question, so I apologise, but I'm just thinking about from a tax point of view and how the UK decides on what whether it's UK domicile for tax purposes or not, and that ultimately comes down to the domicile of the settler and the domicile of the trustees. So I don't think that would affect the position here. So what I'm trying to get at is, surely the transparency we need is more from a tax point of view in the main rather than any other. And I don't think having this power in would change the current law as to whether it's subject to UK taxation and reporting requirements.
Right, OK. Well, that's very clear, considering how woolly my question was. Thank you very much for that, actually. And Rob, do you?
No, I would just echo that. I'm assuming that the intention here is to allow variations to benefit from various tax regimes. And I think if that is the intention, then that should be clear.
Right, OK. Ms. Sonny.
I think the concern the panel had last week was if somebody who is a foreign national sets up a trust, then disappears to another country, that then the domicilio rules could then become a bit unclear. Again, just in practice, is that something that you're dealing with? I think that was the issue. It was more to do with somebody coming in and not having domicilio in Scotland, setting up a trust and then running it from another part of the world without having jurisdiction.
Ask a question or answer a question with a question. Does that, in your question, are you talking about the trustee having created a Scottish trust and put Scottish assets issued in Scotland into, let's say, Scottish land and then disappearing abroad?
Yes.
Right. I think in that situation, it's the beneficiary, the trustees who would decide. The trustor has set up the trust, he's appointed trustees, and my experience normally is the trustees, perhaps with the protector, if it's an offshore trust, being able to agree to that or disagree with it, but certainly having to approve it, where they agree to the change of the what I would call proper law of the trust, i.e. the law that applies to the jurisdiction and how that trust is operated. That would be the trustees who decide that, not the truster generally.
Okay.
I don't think I've seen a trust where the trusters preserve the right to change the proper law?
No. I've not seen such a thing. I'd say that the risk of sounding ignorant, which is, of course, always a risk, the section in question is about protectors. Protectors are a feature of, as I think we've sort of alluded to, offshore trusts and do not have a long and illustrious history in Scottish trust law. This section might then introduce the age of the protector into Scottish trust law. It may not. That will depend very much on whether the advice to those setting up trusts in Scotland is to include a protector. There's no requirement to have one, I dare say. And in the sense that it adds a further degree of control and complication and potentially expense, it may be that Scottish domiciliaries and residents and citizens who set up trusts for Scottish or English or Northern Irish or Welsh beneficiaries may not use a protector. They might. So what I'm saying in a sort of roundabout way is that I would agree that, you know, it isn't just up to the protector what the domicile is for tax purposes, but is this something to be overly concerned about? I'm not sure.
I think on balance, protectors, while not a fixed part of Scottish law, I can see a great use for them going forward as a form of protection for the beneficiaries, which kind of slightly negates the overriding decision-making of the trustees. So I can see some uses for them in Scots law.
Okay, thank you very much. Just then to ask a question on section 61 and the alteration of trust purposes and family trusts, which I think we've dabbled with slightly there. But section 61 says that after such a trust had been in existence, a private trust, for 25 years, the Court of Session will have power to alter the trust purposes, its aims, objectives, etc. So a short or minimum time period can be specified in a legal document creating a particular trust. And in the committee's call for views, 6 of 12 respondents commenting on section 61 said they thought 25 years is too long. I don't want to go too far here, but Alice Pringle of Anderson Strathairn is one of those people who actually suggested this, amongst a number of others, including the Faculty of Advocates, said the imposition of such a lengthy period is notable. So basically, Section 61 gives that power to apply to the court to alter the trust purposes of a family trust, and given the views that 25-year restriction have been mixed, but many have said it's too long, are you satisfied with that time period?
Personally, I think it's too long, and probably best left to the discretion of the trustees. They're the ones that are administering the trust. They're the ones that are running into the problems. If they have the ability to decide at what point the use of the section would be useful, then I think that would be the best route to follow, in my opinion.
Right, thank you.
I understand the need to ensure the wishes of the trustor when setting up the trust. He set out the purposes, but you can't foresee sort of changes in tax regimes and things like that that might not make the way the trust is currently set up satisfactory going forward. And 25 years just seems a bit prescriptive, you know.
Yeah. I think the court oversight in that regard gives that protection. Mm-hmm. They are going to be looking at it in each case, right, rather than setting a minimum of 25 years. They can consider each case on its merits each
right.
time.
That makes sense, yeah. That's nice. Sandy? Yeah.
A material change in circumstances sounds quite dramatic. If something dramatic, why do you have to wait 25 years as well?
Yeah, yeah. Well, that's right, yeah. Any other view? No? Is that okay? No, well, that covers that point, everyone here seems to be of, broadly speaking, the same mind. So that's very useful for our information going forward. So thank you very much indeed. Thank you. Thanks, Convener.
Okay, thank you. And Mercedes Velba.
Thanks, Convener. I'd like to move us on to Section 65 and 66, expenses of litigation. So the Law Society, while supportive of the bill overall, seems very concerned about the current policy underpinning Section 65, which provides principles to determine how legal bills are paid for in trust cases. So the Law Society thinks that Section 65 will deter people from becoming trustees and may actually lead trustees to unfavourably settle or abandon legal proceedings for fear of personal liability. So it would be useful for the committee to hear the panel's views, whether you share the concerns of the Law Society or whether you can offer the committee any reassurance on this point. And then a related question, do you think the availability of insurance helps mitigate against the risks identified by the Law Society? I don't know if either we could start with Ross again and work round. Because I'm remote, it's not easy for you to catch my eye, so I can leave it to the convener to bring you in if that's preferable.
I'm happy to go. Personally, I think the wording of the legislation as it is could potentially be off-putting to potential trustees. I think as soon as you say the words personal liability, then people immediately have concerns. The point of insurance is something that we've looked at previously in respect of various matters that we've come across, and I think that does require to be an option for these circumstances. Ultimately, though, in terms of the guidance that was published with the Act, the personal liability of trustees, you would hope, would be in circumstances of fraud or a complete lack of good faith. But ultimately, I think it could be off-putting, and it would be good to have some clarity as to the extent of circumstances where personal liability would apply.
Thank you.
Yes, I am not a litigator and don't deal with expenses in such matters, as I think I sort of mentioned before, but certainly I would echo Ross's comments that any sort of heightened likelihood or heightened perception of the likelihood of personal liability would undoubtedly put a number of trustees off, notwithstanding the ability to insure against that kind of a risk. As I'm sure we're all aware, insurance always has conditions, and the cost of premiums for insurance will presumably be a trust expense as well, which again
given the requirement, if this stays as it is, will be a drag on the trust fund. I think,
are there any changes you would like to see based on that concern?
Again, I do think it's a balance. I think there has to be the ability to find trustees personally liable, and certain parts of subsection 3, I think, are fine. I think subsection 2 is a little alarming.
Coming out of order, but I was just—I think from a professional trustee point of view, this is concerning because quite commonly, either sort of solicitors, firms, or our trustee companies might be appointed as trustees, and it's managing that risk for business requirements and our insurances. But I did notice that there is the power to us to apply to court to get personal relief. And I don't really know how that would work in practice, but I see it's sort of a way of protecting the trustees to stop them from avoiding sort of taking any action, that their position would be covered in that event. I suppose ultimately, where do those costs fall then in that case? Sorry.
That's fine. I think it would be dangerous just to always rely on insurance, because in many cases insurance can't be obtained if litigation is in contemplation. That may be one of the questions asked in the application for insurance, in which case the premium may be sky high and unaffordable, or just the trust will be uninsurable. So I think the danger here is that you kind of, it's back to the balance I talked about earlier, balancing the trustees and the beneficiaries. And I think you've got to be quite clear where the balance lies. And my concern, I'm sure, with Ross, is that you may find yourself in a situation where the trustees are looking down the barrel of personal liability, but they're doing the best for the trust, and that therefore skews their perception and their decision-making. And a decision is made by the trustees that might not be to the best benefit of all of the beneficiaries, but only those who are agitating via this court action. And I think, therefore, this clause does cause me concern as far as personal liability is concerned.
Thank you.
Joseph?
No, I have nothing to add to that. Similar to, as Sandy mentioned, I'm not a litigator either, and therefore I'd be reluctant to comment with any certainty as to or with any particular views on that.
Okay, thank you. Mercedes, anything else?
Happy to leave it there, Convener. Thank you.
Okay, thank you. And Jeremy.
Thank you, Convener. If I can move us on now to section 67 of the bill. The Faculty of Advocates and others have said that they think the power in section 67 of the bill to give directions to the court needs to be much wider than the power which currently appears in the bill. Again, I'd just be interested to get your views of whether you agree it needs to be wider, if it's about right, or anything around that. Or are you happy with that as it is?
I think in balance, wider. Ultimately, if it's going to the court can draw back what's being asked for. But if they can't go further than what's being asked for, then that may in turn cause a problem. So I would agree with the Faculty of Advocates that wider would be better here, on the basis that ultimately the court will decide, and that's your supervision of the trustees and what they're asking for.
Is everyone in agreement?
Absolutely, yes.
Yeah. Thank you.
Okay, thank you. And back to Mercedes.
Thanks, Convener. So moving on to section 72 in part 2 of the bill on the right of a spouse or civil partner to inherit. So this is obviously the part of the bill dealing with succession law. So various stakeholders, including the Law Society, have said that a distinction should be drawn between spouses or civil partners who were living with the deceased person at the time of their death, and those spouses or civil partners who had previously separated from the deceased person, but hadn't actually divorced or had the partnership dissolved. So it would be helpful for the committee to hear the panel's views on this policy idea of this distinction, and whether you agree with good drafting of the provision, it's possible to describe and define what is separation and what is not, because obviously we're aware that there's circumstances when people may be living separately, but the relationship is very much still together. It's through reasons out with their control. They might be in prison, they might be working overseas. So do you think it's possible to draft a clear distinction in those circumstances? And would it be helpful?
In that distinction, and also specifically relate to people that might be in care or something like that, where you know you're covering the eventualities where the relationship hasn't broken down but they're no longer living together. I think it's a welcome change, because I think it reflects what people probably think would happen if they died without a will, this change. But I can also see the negative downside if we don't specifically clarify what the position is, where you have a case where someone is estranged from their spouse or civil partner, and where they are then in line to inherit their estate when that is not their intention at all.
Thank you, if I can. I think drawing a distinction would be helpful, but I don't think it would be possible. I think in practice, if there was a distinction about kind of separation or timescale for being apart, then I can imagine a potential beneficiary saying that wasn't the case, or that didn't happen, or we weren't doing those things. So I think it would be really difficult to draw that distinction. I think the position should be that if you are separated, you have a separation agreement where you forfeit certain rights. As I say, it would be helpful, but I don't think it would be possible to do in a way that would give sufficient clarity.
So often people in this situation, you know, they're cohabiting, there's nothing in writing, there's unlikely to be anything in writing when they stop cohabiting. And therefore, I think if we are to proceed with this, we have to come up with some sort of wording which shows the difference between people who are living together cohabiting, or husband and wife, and those who are separated. Now, we have it for tax purposes. And it should, if we're going to proceed with this, it should be included. Another minor point, I'm just slightly concerned that we've got tacked on to the back of a trust bill, a succession section, and I do wonder whether it might be better to just separate them. I know it's different, another act, but it just seems where it's kind of tacked on at the back, and it would be nice to have a kind of full succession bill that covers everything and not just tacking things on. But that's just an observation, it's not a criticism.
Certainly, I know it's certainly the, obviously, mothers around the room, even folks sitting behind you, are actually nodding their head in agreement to that point as well. So, yeah. Caroline, did you want to come back in?
No, I agree completely with that comment. I think they're two quite separate matters, and there's also quite a lot of change or consolidation happening in terms of trust that to put the two together is a little bit confusing.
Okay.
I think whatever decision is taken with regards to Section 72, I think public awareness could be made of how that will operate in practice for those that don't have a will. It would be really beneficial.
I think, broadly speaking, from my experience, what is being proposed to change is what the general public thinks is the case anyway. And telling them that is not the case at the moment can produce incredulity occasionally. Certainly, I agree, I think, broadly, that it's something that is to be welcomed, subject, though, I think, to what was stated about some kind of provision for, you know, separated spouses. And whilst I understand Ross's position. I think I fall more onto John's view that there needs to be some kind of provision to take into account this, notwithstanding that it is difficult to avoid those who are, you know, through choice or necessity, living separately but are still married. There must, as John says, be some way of putting something together that works. Because I think that that would be essential for it. And the curiosity, and again, it is sufficiently common that one comes across it in practice fairly regularly that people are separated but have not divorced. So I think it needs to be looked at.
And in terms of how that would work practically, I guess I'm putting you all on the spot now. I mean, would it require some kind of formal separation agreement? Or, I mean, it cut out slightly when Ross was speaking, but I thought I heard him say it would be helpful but impossible. So I'm interested to understand how we might be able to make it work, to have that distinction.
Yeah, I think my point was it would be helpful, but I'm not sure it would be possible, and that the waiving or forfeiture of those rights should come by way of separation agreement. So that there is clarity on that point. I just, in practice, if you tell someone, no, you are not getting this thing because this is what the rule says, then they will come at us with ways of trying to skirt that. And I'm not sure you could draft in a way that would address all of those possibilities. And therefore, I think a separation agreement would be the preference here.
And I don't disagree at all that would be ideal, but if someone hasn't got a will, then it seems perhaps unlikely that they may, and they haven't, you know, they are cohabiting, they haven't thought to regularise it with a cohabitation agreement, for instance. It seems also unlikely that they may not have a formal separation agreement. So I think some form of attempt to address it within the law would be desirable.
I'm going to put you on the spot then, just in this. Would you have any form of wording that you think could be useful?
as a matter of fact, in my bag, no.
It might be worthwhile. I mean, if there is anything, obviously after today, maybe send something in.
Yes. I think it's always dangerous to make up wording on the hoof. So
no, absolutely. I'm certainly not suggesting that.
We're happy to come back to you with some suggested wording, but you know, it might not be acceptable, but we will apply our minds to it.
I'm not saying that it's wording in particular, but I was talking with John and Alan Barr outside earlier on, and I recalled the provisions of the old marriage by cohabitation with habit and repute, which I see grins are in the room with lawyers who will remember this from their lot, where partly it's to do with what people know you as. Are you known as, to your friends and family, as being in a relationship? Or are you not? And that there can be evidence led in that respect, I suppose.
And can I just clarify in that
respect? If I'm, say, a couple and one goes into a care home for a very long period of time, what happens in practice at the moment? Is there any thought of having to put something in writing? You know, so someone's been in a care home for 3 or 4 years, the other person's living at home. How in practice do you deal with that so that people don't lose out?
I think it depends on the circumstances. I mean, the chances are in that situation, as you've outlined, the partner who's still at home will still be visiting their spouse in the home, probably regularly. And I suppose it comes down to capacity as well. Is the person in the home incapable, therefore they can't decide to separate at one level? So I think it just we have to be very careful, and that's down to the intention of the parties. It's down to the reality of their life, which is different for different people. But nevertheless, I think legislation should be able to cope with that, hopefully not too woolly.
Because I think the other one that was raised with us last week by clearly academics is if someone goes onto a submarine for a long length of service, that type of issue was, or someone who is away again for a long period of time, is that an issue that concerns you in practice?
Again, it would come down to intention of the parties. You know, someone in a submarine clearly is there because they have to be there. They didn't intend to leave their spouse, it's just they're forced to be there as part of their duties. So you know, if they don't intend to be separated, then I think that would be fine. If they, you know, the other end of the spectrum is those who have separated, and back to Sandy's point about marriage with cohabitant repute, if you know, it's accepted to their friends that they are no longer partners or cohabiting or spouses, then I think that's a different interpretation and result that can come from that.
Okay, that's helpful. If I may, Commissioner, just I appreciate we probably don't want to rewrite the law of succession on a Tuesday morning, but the bill does open the tin of worms slightly. And the one area that we looked at again last week with the academics was around legal rights and whether there should be a greater restriction on the law of legal rights. And I understand in some continental European countries, I think Poland and Germany, you can write into your will to almost not completely get rid of them, but certainly delete them even further than we have. I appreciate, again, putting you on the spot to ask you to comment on this, but is that an area that you think is worth pursuing, or do you think we've got the balance about right around legal rights?
Discussion, but I don't think personally I could sit here today and say I think this should be the rule on legal rights or I think that should be the rule on legal rights. I think it's beneficial that we have clarity at the moment. The English position on this matter, which is kind of where I would draw comparisons, is very vague. If you can demonstrate that you were dependent on someone and they ought to have made provision for you in respect of their estate, then it, basically you can make a claim, but that will fall down to the court and their discretion, and that can lead to long, drawn-out, protracted litigation, which really benefits nobody but lawyers. So I think the fact that we have clarity is beneficial, but I think your question of is it worth exploring, potentially yes, but I don't think that any of us, not to speak for my colleagues, could say it should be this or it should be that at this stage.
I agree. I think reform of legal rights has been something that's been mooted for years and years and years, and I don't think anyone has come up with an answer to what would be the ideal scenario. It's sort of balancing the, sort of the freedom of the testator with sort of obligations, and you know, things have been mooted about, you know, giving a limit to children that are, say, under the age of 25 in full-time education, or you know, are actually dependent on the testator and that type of thing. I don't know the answer, and today is probably not the day, because I think it's a whole act in itself, it's a whole bill in itself, and a lot to kind of consider. You've also got to think about the people that this, any changes it would affect, because a lot of strategies are put in place currently around the current things to ensure that, especially sort of, I'm thinking farming and landed estates, that things can pass on to heirs and things like that. So it's very, very tricky area to kind of navigate, whilst at the same time understanding why that principle is there in the first place. Also, 20 years is a long time to claim legal rights.
Yes, indeed. And I echo what Caroline says there, that it's a balance. The testator thinks they have entire freedom to deal with their estate as they wish and are outraged to find out that they actually have to leave a portion of their estate to their children or their spouse. On the other hand, the beneficiary deserves protection from capricious or abusive treatment from those on whom they are perhaps entitled to depend. Both can be true. It's about balancing the two. And I think where Scots law has an advantage in a way is that there is a degree of certainty as to what anyone is due, and one can advise on that. I would, again, as Ross mentioned, I'd be very keen to avoid the possibility of, oh well, let's leave it up to the court to decide, because at least with certainty you know where you're going with administering an estate. If you have to then worry about 6 months, a year, 2 years, 5 years, 20 years of litigation, I'm not convinced that's in anyone's interest.
Thank you.
Okay. Mercedes, anything else you want to? Okay, thank you.
Thank you,
Right. So we move to part two of the bill. The committee has heard suggestions of three policy proposals which could be added to the part two. So first of all, the creating of exceptions to legal rights as they currently apply to protect from disinheritance. That was from Professor Paisley last week. Secondly, amending the current strict six-month time limit, which applies in the context of the cohabitant's power to apply to the court for a share of the deceased's estate. That was from the Faculty of Advocates and Yvonne Evans. Thirdly, the clarifying that the law does not permit an unlawful killer to be an executor of the victim's estate. That was from Professors Paisley and Gretton. So what are your views on these three proposals, and do you think they should be added to part two of the bill, and do you think that there are any other changes that should be made to part two of the bill?
Do you mind the order in which we deal with it, or can I just say about the...
No.
Take the cohabitation section. I mean, I think that 6 months is rather a short period, and I'm pretty sure most practitioners agree it ought to be a bit longer, which you might find strange given that I just said that you don't want to be waiting too long for litigation, but I do think 6 months is quite short for such matters. Given that these Section 29 claims can only come about during an intestacy, and where there is a cohabitant, I don't think there's any harm in extending the period. It's not as if it's going to be every estate one deals with. I think more broadly, though, I would welcome root and branch reform of Section 29, and I would point the committee to the comments of, I think, Lady Smith and Lord Drummond Young in Kerr against Mangan from 2014, where they said this really needs to just be, you know, changed. So there's much more clarity on what the court is to take into account when coming to a decision on Section 29 matters.
Okay, thank you. John?
I think the unlawful killer not being executor makes eminent sense. There's nothing worse than not being, you know, being a beneficiary state where the person who has killed your beloved spouse, whatever, child, is then in charge of administering the estate. I think that just seems to add insult to injury, quite frankly, so it makes sense.
Do you have any views on the other two suggestions?
Legal rights, I always use legal rights as being part of public policy. It's been a part of Scots law forever, and therefore I think we have to, as a profession, look to you as politicians to say what you think is best. Now, we'll come back and probably say it's maybe wrong or it could be done better, but that's our role, you have your role, and I'll leave it at that, I think.
Okay. Thank you. Caroline?
In relation to the cohabitants, I can understand why the six-month period was included when the legislation was drafted. It sort of ties in when you're ascertaining the debts of the deceased's estate, and that's probably why that figure was reached. But as Sandy alluded to, you know, this is probably not in every scenario. It's only in intestate cases, and in practice, it will occur relatively rarely. So to extend that period in those circumstances would seem favourable. I suppose I want to go one step further. And again, it's probably too much to cover in this current bill. Is my concern is with modern family dynamics and situations, there is just so many more people cohabiting and not living, not marrying or entering into civil partnerships, that to restrict this only to matters of intestacy, how you legislate for the other side presents a whole other problem. But I do think it is quite the rights of cohabitants remain very, very limited.
Okay, thank you. Joseph?
I would agree with Caroline there about the six-month timeline. I can sort of see the logic and how that links to the ascertaining debts on the estate, but in reality, getting an executory started can take a few months in itself, depending on what's happening, particularly in intestacy scenarios, ascertaining if there is a will or not. Before you know it, you can be a couple of months down the line, and you know. So I do think extending that is a good start, and I think reviewing the rights of cohabitants generally, as Caroline suggested, in line with modern times is a good idea as well. Whether that and the other suggestions can be added to this bill, I'm not sure if it's the right bill to do it on. Similar to what John mentioned earlier, it does feel that the succession elements of this particular bill have been slightly, there's more to add on. And if there are to be further changes to succession law, I think maybe a separate bill dealing with this would be beneficial for clarity's sake, if nothing else.
Okay, thank you.
I would agree. I think kind of hopefully made my point on the legal rights position, which is that far greater discussion is needed. And I agree with Sandy in terms of the Section 29 applications. Changing from 6 months to 12 months is really just slightly changing what we have at the moment, whereas actually there needs to be a more thorough review of that particular policy, because it isn't always appropriate for family life as it is at the moment. There can be wills from 30 years ago and then cohabiting for 30 years, and ultimately that cohabitant misses out. And that isn't necessarily what the deceased would have intended. So I think, by all means, change the time limit, but I don't think that actually addresses the public policy point on this, which is what do the general public want, or what would they expect in those circumstances. And as far as unlawful killers is concerned, I think that's simply common sense that it doesn't apply.
Okay, thank you. Do we have any other questions for the panel? Okay, Mercedes? No? Okay. So with that, I'd like to thank the panel for your helpful evidence this morning, and certainly the committee may follow up by letter with any additional questions stemming from what has been discussed this morning. But also, I think there'll be a couple of points that we'll come back, that yourselves will come back to us on. And certainly not about redrafting a whole section, but any potential hints would be quite useful. So thank you. So with that, is there anything that the panel would like to highlight that's not been covered, or anything they'd like to put on the record?
I just have one point.
Yeah, sure.
If I may, I think the definition of beneficiary could be clearer, to come back to Caroline's point earlier. Primarily the types of trusts that my firm deal with are discretionary trusts, in which the trustees effectively have unfettered discretion as to how they benefit those beneficiaries. And we've had quite a number of cases where there are discretionary / potential beneficiaries seeking to disrupt the actions of the trustees or the distribution of the trust estate. And the powers contained within the Act, depending on how it's interpreted, potentially give those beneficiaries powers that the trustor may not have intended. So I think greater clarity around the rights of purely discretionary beneficiaries would be helpful.
Okay, well, thank you. Sandy?
I wanted to say that there is, in Section 8 of the bill, talks about the removal of trustee by beneficiaries where all beneficiaries are of age and capable and are absolutely entitled to the trust property. They can remove a trustee. I do wonder, should there be the ability to add a further trustee if the property needs to be administered and remains in the name of trustees? Section 68 allows completion of title by beneficiaries. A beneficiary absolutely entitled to property, title which has been taken in the name of a trustee who has died or become incapable without having executed a conveyance, but that's not the same as the trustees having been removed by beneficiary under Section 8. So if we're going to look at tying up the ability to actually move property from the name of trustees to beneficiaries, which presumably is the idea of Section 8, does that need to be tied together?
Okay, well, thank you. John?
I think from my perspective, Section 40 has to be looked at. I'm slightly concerned that Section 40, particularly when dealing with the sale of land and a disposition being signed by trustees, and it's to be executed by a majority of such of the body of trustees, are both capable and traceable. And I think we will come into questions from, and quite rightly so, by conveyancers on the other side who are buying property, where they're saying, well, prove the other trustees shouldn't be signing. And certainly under the existing Trust Act, the majority of trustees sign, and you've actually sorted all the problems out beforehand. So if you've got an incapable trustee or untraceable trustee, you sort that out before you sell the land. So at the point of selling, generally, that you have a kind of clean decision-making process, as it were. There may be advantages, but I think, on balance, the other side who are buying will want to make sure they've got a good title. And if you've then got to prove that the trustee is incapable or the trustee is untraceable, then that creates more problems than I think this section solves.
Okay, no, thank you. Caroline.
I was going to mention accumulation periods and the fact that they won't have retrospective effect. I think in the majority of my scenarios, I think actually it would be welcome to many people administering trusts if they did have retrospective effect, but I can completely understand if it was something specifically stipulated in the document at the time. I think it just gives another degree of flexibility to be able to reinvest that sum. I think obviously it depends on the type of trust and whether subject to vesting of beneficiaries and things like that. But where it's a fully discretionary trust, I don't know whether we necessarily need to limit to trusts that are coming into existence and following the passing of the Act.
Okay.
I think the other point that I may be picking up on accumulation is. I think it's surprising it doesn't apply to charities as well. So you could have a situation where a charity 1 year, let's say, has been going for 21 years and there's no power to accumulate. So 1 year it might not spend all its money, and the trustees may think actually be useful just to capitalise that, to reinvest it, to provide for the future. And I'm slightly surprised the accumulation period has not been abolished for charities as well on the basis it would ease charities administration, I think.
OK, no, thank you. And Joseph.
I would agree about the accumulation periods, both with what John and Caroline said. I think it would be beneficial for it to have retrospective effect, particularly when the trust deed itself has a wording that is flexible enough to account for changes in lawful accumulation periods. Similarly, I think it should, I'm not quite sure of the reason why it doesn't apply to charity, so I do think that could be looked at. Other than that, there are just small sort of more drafting and more sort of word-specific tweaks that probably don't merit going into in a huge amount of depth in this forum, but they are part of our written submission anyway. Yeah. And there will be time to sort of flesh those things out in more detail, but other than that, I don't think there's anything that I would that's glaringly missing that could be added, other than perhaps we were talked earlier about the duty to account to beneficiaries generally and what information they should receive. I think clarification on the duty to provide accounting, specifically trust accounts to beneficiaries, this is an opportune time to clarify the parameters of that duty, whether that's part of section 25 and 26 or otherwise. I think it could be added in here.
Okay. No, that's helpful. Thank you very much. So thank you once again. And with that, I'll now suspend the session briefly to allow for the change of the panel. Thank you. For our second panel, can I welcome Alan Barr, the Convener of Trusts and Succession Law, the Subcommittee at the Law Society of Scotland. Laura Dunlop KC, a Convener of the Faculty's Law Reform Committee at the Faculty of Advocates. Sarah Jim MacDonald, a Committee Member of STEP Scotland. And Ken Swinton, a Council Member of the Scottish Law Agents Society. And, but beforehand, to Jeremy, is there anything you want to...
You're first.
Yeah, if you want to, anything you want to declare.
I declared for the first panel.
Thank you. So also, once again, I note Mercedes Velba will be joining us online shortly. And we have received apologies from Oliver Mundell. So what, can I remind the panel that to not worry about turning on the microphones during the session, as these are controlled by broadcasting. And if you would like to come in on any question, please just raise your hand or indicate to the clerks, and that there is also no need to answer every question. Simply indicate that this is not for you to respond. However, please feel free to follow up in writing to any question after the meeting if you wish. So I'll open the questions. So on the 2nd of May, the Scottish Law Commission said to the committee that it's very important that the trust law reforms ultimately apply to pension trusts as well. The current plan is for this to have effect through the Section 104 order agreed between both Scottish and UK governments. And do you share the views that this bill should apply to pension trusts in whole or in part? And what would the practical impact be for you if there was a gap between the legislation coming into force for most trusts and then the legislation coming into force for pension trusts?
I think that it would not be a disaster if there was that gap. The one that I think it's important to distinguish between two different types of pension trusts. The ones that are excluded here by the definition is pension schemes established under trust, as opposed to private trusts which contain elements of pension rights. And they will be affected by the Act, if it becomes an Act, in the normal way, as with other private trusts. I think that the pension scheme trust is a large and specialised area. I don't think it would be a disaster if the Act did not affect them. The companies that are running such pension trusts are big, bruising, and able to look after themselves. And I suspect that the vast majority of what would be covered as a default by this Act is already covered in such pension scheme trusts. So while, as a matter of consistency, trusts under Scots law will include pension scheme trusts and therefore they should be covered, I don't think it would be absolutely awful if they were not, or indeed if there was a delay in that coverage happening.
Okay, thank you.
Yeah, I think I agree. I mean, there's a distinction drawn between sort of pension scheme trusts and general trusts that deal with sort of pension payouts, things like that. For trust registration and our sort of anti-money laundering rules that we have, we certainly have those that were registered under the Finance Act back in 2004, various scheme arrangements that are treated as trusts but aren't necessarily trusts in the classic sense. So I think, as Alan said, they'll have their own sort of rules and regulations. I don't tend to deal with those myself. It's more the classic type of trusts I deal with. But I think the main driver here is to actually just get trust law reform. And I think, as my colleagues were saying earlier, it's not necessarily a deal breaker to have this bill dealing with trusts and then have pensions dealt with separately.
Thank you. Laura?
I would defer to the others on that. The faculty is not involved in the technicalities of these matters, so my colleagues have much more experience than I do.
Okay, thank you. All right, Ken.
I have nothing to add, really. The last time I was involved in a pension scheme trust was in the 1970s, so I think I'm well out of touch on
that. No, thank you. Jeremy.
Thank you, Committee, and good morning to the panel. You have the advantage that you know the questions that we asked you the previous panel, so hopefully we can make progress. As I said to the previous panel, as you'll be aware, there are new powers for the Sheriff Court, but predominantly the main powers still lie in the Court of Session. I wonder whether you have a view on this, and maybe to start with Laura Dunlop on behalf of the faculty.
I would, I think, associate myself with the comments that Lord Drummond Young made when he gave evidence. I wouldn't see the faculty as differing from him on what he said about the Court of Session, but there are plainly pragmatic reasons for having some powers capable of exercising the share of court. The only point which struck me when I was preparing for today's session, and this is very much just, I think it is a drafting point, but it's probably worth mentioning here, that I know you are interested in the provision about the expenses of litigation in which trusts are involved, and I've listened to the discussion about that with the previous panel. It did strike me that the definition of court in section 74 doesn't include section 65, which is the new litigation expenses section. I'm not sure if that's been mentioned, but I would have thought that if there is to be this highly nuanced approach to the expenses of litigation, you would want that section to cover litigation involving trusts in the share of court as well as in the Court of Session. So I was wondering if it might be a good idea to include section 65 in the definition of court in section 74.
That's helpful.
So I apologise if that's been mentioned already, but it's just something that struck me. So it may be that there's a reason why it isn't, but I couldn't think what that reason would be.
No, I think that hadn't been raised before, so that's helpful. We can pursue that.
Right.
Do others have a view on this?
I think one of the key things that struck me when I was reading it and discussing it with some of our colleagues was in relation to being able to obtain a power from the court. So historically, that was done with the Sheriff Court rather than the Court of Session. And we come across this a lot in practice, where if you don't have a power in a trust deed, you can request it under the current 1921 Act. The one that I see most often is in relation to wills that say, I direct you to hold this house during the lifetime of X. So you don't have a power to sell without going to the court, because that's at variance with the trust deed. Now, at the moment, that can be done at Sheriff Court, but this would actually put that into the Court of Session. And again, I think one of the points that was made earlier by my colleagues is actually to have a choice between the Court of Session or the Sheriff Court would be useful. As again, as one of the points said earlier, there's not much of a difference in cost these days between the two, and sometimes you will want a sort of Court of Session case to have the more learned judges perhaps in this area, but sometimes it's, for ease, swifter to get it done through the Sheriff Court, and I've certainly seen instances where we've wanted to sell quickly, the reasons for going to the Sheriff Court in that scenario. So I think having the choice, again, would be really useful, particularly in circumstances like that.
Thank you.
And Jeremy.
John, again, a trustee, as you'll be aware, does not get participation in trust decisions under Section 12 when they're incapable. Trustees can also remove a fellow trustee from their role on the basis that a trustee is incapable. There's a risk of abuse of these provisions being highlighted both by the Law Society and by other legal stakeholders. The academics who appeared before the committee last week were more relaxed about this possible risk. I wonder again, from a more of a practitioner's perspective, are you concerned about this? Are you happy with it? Is there anything you would want to add to it?
I think that the Law Society were among those concerned. I think there's a broader concern of the definition of incapable, which I know perhaps will come up again later, is tied to but is not exactly the same as, and certainly there's not of the same kind of nuances as the Adults with Incapacity Act. And I think that it would be good that it were more closely tied, and just picking up on a point made earlier, I think that kind of future-proofing it for further work that is going on in that definition would be extremely helpful. I think that there are dangers, particularly in the removal of a trustee deemed by his or her fellow trustees to be incapable. And because I don't think there's anything that said that it's simply that if they are incapable, other trustees can remove them. And that, I think, is dangerous, because those wishing to remove have a vested interest in it, therefore have a vested interest in defining somebody as incapable, albeit with the benefit of a definition. But is that definition is by its very nature subjective to a significant extent. And the protection for the alleged incapable person seems to me somewhat limited in what is there. So I think that there needs to be to be further thought on that. I know that Adrian Ward, he may well have written to the committee separately, has concerns about the definition of incapable, notably that it's a kind of free-floating in limbo definition, whereas in the law more generally on incapacity, it's a question of incapable of what? Incapacity being a spectrum rather than an on-off switch, and therefore that needs to be taken account of. In other words, it would have to be incapacity in relation to acting as a trustee or even to some parts of acting as a trustee. And I think that that does require further work. It may well get it through other legislative means that are happening anyway, but it then needs to be tied back to this change because incapacity features on one or two occasions within the bill.
To pick up on a couple of things there. When I was speaking with various people, one of the issues that came up around the definition of incapacity was whether it should be within this Act or with reference, as was suggested earlier, to the Adults with Incapacity Scotland Act that we have. And I think one of the suggestions that was mentioned when I was speaking to various practitioners is actually if you tie it to the Act, you're then suggesting that Scots law applies to trustees of Scottish Trusts, even if they are not Scots law jurisdiction persons, and that can cause its own problems as well. And I think having it in the Act at least means that we are saying this is the definition of incapacity that applies to trustees of Scottish trusts. Otherwise, you would need to say something like, if they are incapable in terms of the Adults with Incapacity Scotland Act, or within the Mental Capacity Act England, or within the Mental Capacity Act Northern Ireland, or within their own jurisdiction. And I think if you start going that far, you're then also having to say, well, what is their jurisdiction? Are they incapable in that jurisdiction? Needing to get an opinion on law in that jurisdiction, and it creates more barriers, whereas having it within this Act and saying, actually, this is the definition we are using for a Scottish trustee, then that it sort of circumvents those issues. So yes, you can future-proof by having reference to external acts, but you've then got added barriers to actually being able to define what capacity is if you are doing that. So it's sort of got other practical hoops that you've got to jump around. But I definitely share Alan's concerns and the Law Society's concerns around the ability for abuse here. And I think the point is that it's a very subjective view as to what is incapacity. And the example that I've come across in practice and discussed with various other people is where someone perhaps has a mental health issue or something like that that gives them difficulties in making decisions and whether or not that would prohibit them from being a trustee. And I think if they are excluded as a trustee on the basis of that, there's risks there of discrimination claims. If they're saying, well, I've been discriminated against because I have a mental health problem or this health issue and I've been excluded on that basis. But there's also other risks there where actually it could be used in the wrong way in contentious situations. So particularly if you've got, say, two warring family members and one thinks that their, say, sibling is incapable because of one reason or another, if they make that view and they do some sort of minute of trustees saying, I am now sole trustee because my sibling is incapable, they could then appoint the whole trust fund to members of their family and completely exclude the other. And there's a lot of risk there for abuse around actually not just excluding that person when they might take issue with that, but also having the trust fund paid out to other parties. So I think some form of protection in the Act would be really useful, whether it's just intimating to the person that they're being removed so that they then know that's happening, and then if they want to take issue with it or argue it, they can take legal advice on that. But at the moment, there's no requirement to even tell them that they're being removed. There's nothing in the bill that makes that a necessity. So the other trustee could remove them, crack on, wind up the trust, and that person would never even know that that's happened. And that just seems a very risky thing to have, particularly because then the remedy for the other beneficiaries who have potentially lost out would be really difficult to try and undo all of that.
I did want to say something about this whole area this morning. I'm not sure if we're taking it out of order, you know, if there's an intention to come back to it, or should I just go for it now? Okay. We've kind of started on this. I was a commissioner at the Law Commission when the Trust's report was coming to a conclusion, and I can remember the discussions we had around this, and to some extent, you know, I was in favour of moving away from the definition that we currently have in Scots law of incapable, which, as everyone knows, is in the two pieces of mental health legislation, the Adults with Incapacity Act 2000 and the Mental Health Care and Treatment Act 2003. So far in Scots law, we've just had one definition of incapable and we have one definition of mental disorder. There is a nesting phenomenon here so that you have someone is incapable and that is as a result of mental disorder. So both these terms are specifically defined, and as I say, at the moment, we work across Scots law with one definition. It would be very unusual to have different definitions of the same term in different areas of law, although it occasionally happens, and this might be an area in which one would move into having a different definition of incapacity. So I wanted to make that point. What we did, or what was done at the Law Commission, was that actually it was the then current definition in English law that was to some extent not quite copied, but you know, whatever the opposite of putting a kilt on something is, we looked at the English definition in the mental health legislation of 2007 in England and took that, although it's slightly reworked. And the other thing that was done was to drop the reference to acting. So it's the reference in this legislation to what you're incapable of is all decision related. It doesn't also add that you're incapable of acting. There is, as everyone knows, a lot of work going on in relation to reform in mental health and incapacity law. And actually, I was at a meeting to discuss where that is headed last week. And I think the bill team for this bill are liaising with people who are knowledgeable about that project as well. It's certainly possible to have a definition for the time being in this legislation and then for it to be changed as part of reform in mental health and incapacity law generally. There are, with the definition of mental disorder in the 2003 Act, there are currently sensitivities around what's included in that definition, and there are sensitivities around what's not included in that definition. So this is very delicate and sensitive work. And, you know, talking about future proofing, well, certainly making it flexible seems to me a very important goal. But we will need something for the time being. I think finally to say I think less concerned about claims for discrimination, because under the Equality Act, there are only claims in relation to specific areas of activity. It's not as though there is a kind of general prohibition on taking into account what will be a cognitive impairment. There are some situations in which necessarily cognitive impairment has to be taken into account, and that does not necessarily give rise to any claim for discrimination.
Okay, well, thank you.
Just to follow up on a couple of those issues. There was a suggestion, I think, made in the first panel about getting some kind of medical evidence, which would give you evidence around that. Would that be something you would be, think would be helpful in regard to giving protection maybe to the trustee that's been challenged on that, that we would have to provide medical evidence?
Yes, I think medical evidence is almost always helpful. There would be, I think, related questions on what kind of medic you're talking about. You know, there is, I think, an increasing awareness that it isn't just psychiatrists who can give useful medical evidence about this, and then you would also want to consider whether psychologists could be involved. So that would be one comment I would make in relation to medical evidence. And the other comment I would make is that it shouldn't be solely a question of medical evidence, I don't think, because there are other professionals and other people who are involved with someone who can give very cogent evidence. And in my work in the Mental Health Tribunal, we frequently receive information from mental health officers who are specialist social workers, which is very valuable in assessing capacity as well.
I think that the medical evidence bit is important just as part of other evidence, conceivably, and may indeed give some comfort. But I agree entirely, it must not be the binding thing, as it is not in relation to other legal acts now, because
again, coming back to capacity is not an on-off switch. It's capacity in relation to a trust. Just as when I am drawing up a will for somebody, it's in the end my judgment, perhaps with input from medical evidence, of the person being capable of understanding the legal act for which I am responsible for providing the ammunition, as it were. So I think as long as it's not thought to be binding, medical evidence is helpful, should not be required, and must not be, as I say, binding in the end.
On that, one thing that we always need to keep in mind is also being practical. If there's things that need to be done and moved on, I mean, the reason for having this in here was to stop people going to court just to remove someone because of incapacity, and to focus on situations where you've got, say, two trustees and one's incapable because they have dementia or something like this and they aren't able to sign documents or understand them. If you're needing to sell a house, going to court to have that trustee removed just to then have one trustee left to be able to action that, it adds a lot of cost to it. So I think being practical is key here as well. So I think, as Alan said, there shouldn't be a requirement to get medical evidence. I think in those cases where there is a clear trustee who is incapable, being able to do it quickly and being able to get a house on the market, things like that need to be done swiftly. If you were to require a mental health officer's report or something like that, you could add months to your timescale of getting things done. So I think there are 90% of the scenarios probably where there's not an issue with a trustee that's incapable. All parties will know that is what is happening and you'll be able to proceed. I think it's just those few and far between cases where there is an opportunity there for abuse that causes the problem, which is why perhaps just having a requirement to intimate the intention to remove a trustee would then allow that person to argue it if they want, and obviously if they don't want to, then things can just proceed as normal, and it avoids that requirement for court or requirement for medical evidence and things like that that may add delays or barriers to actually being able to progress the trust and do what's necessary.
That's helpful. Thank you.
Thank you. I've got a supplementary just to Alan. Alan, earlier on, you indicated that in terms of incapacity as a spectrum and in terms of trusts, you could look at excluding people from specific aspects, the decision-making of specific aspects of a trust. How easy or difficult would that actually be?
No, I wasn't. If I said, I apologise, I didn't intend to indicate that people should be excluded from specific aspects. All I was saying is that people's capacity over different things that they may do will vary considerably, and it may well be that people are perfectly capable of managing their own affairs, but not the affairs of a trust, with the nuances and the interests of third parties that brings. So there's perhaps a difference in capacity to do different things. You're right, of course, within a trust, within acting as a trustee, there will again be things that people are capable of doing and not capable of doing. And I just think that the account needs to be taken of that spectrum. In other words, capacity needs to be judged in the terms in which the act, I don't mean this act, in terms of the juridical act, the legal act that is intended to be carried out.
Okay, thank you. Is it Ken?
Sorry, I was just wanting to come in and say the incapability may not be permanent, so removing a trustee may be a remedy that is a step too far in that situation where there is a prospect of their recovering capacity, say following a stroke or something like that.
Is that Section 12 deals with that in the sense that it means that a quorum for trustees for making decisions is a majority for the time being of those who have capacity. So there's not a requirement to remove someone if they don't have capacity for a specific time. And I do think, as Ken said, that removing them may be a step too far if there is that prospect of them having capacity again in the future. Just another point I was going to mention before we move on. Under Section 5, which deals with the resignation of trustees, it says that a trustee can't resign if they're the sole trustee, but I wonder if that should be the sole capable trustee, just to avoid scenarios where someone resigns and leaves just incapable trustees, which then means that the trust can't then be administered, just whilst we're talking about incapacity.
Okay.
Can I just come on back one point? How does that then relate, or does it relate at all, to the other bill going through Parliament will go through Parliament like charities, where the court
can appoint, sorry, Oscar can appoint interim trustees if there are no trustees capable of working? Would that not, if there was a trustee that somebody stepped down and there was a trustee who was incapable of doing that, would Oscar not just appoint an interim trustee temporarily to keep it going?
Well, I'm talking about the sort of non-charitable trusts here. So there's remedies in terms of this Act for certain situations to have incapable trustees removed by the court or other beneficiaries to do it under Section 8 if the beneficiaries have vested in it. But my understanding is there wouldn't be an interim in this situation.
No, I don't. I mean, I think the big difference is that with charitable trustees, there is a third-party body such as Oscar automatically involved in supervision. In more general trusts, we only have the courts or the trustees themselves. We don't have, as it were, a third-party supervisor who could appoint an interim trustee.
Thank you.
Okay. Thank you. Mercedes.
Thank you, convener. Good morning, panel. So, as you will have heard from the previous panel, we have a similar section. So, I'd like to move us on to section 16 and 17, trustees' powers of investment. And some of you may have heard earlier on me ask a question related to this. So the Law Society, and we also heard from the academic Yvonne Evans last week, and both of them have suggested that in view of Scotland's increasing emphasis on net zero, that section 16 and 17 could be amended to allow trusts to adopt environmentally friendly investment policies, particularly when these investments might underperform compared to other investments. So as I asked the previous panel, it would be helpful for the committee to hear your views on this idea, if you support it in principle, if you think section 16 and 17 could be amended or tweaked to make it clearer that investments of that sort are possible for trustees, to make it clear to them that they do have the power to make those investments. I don't know if it would make sense perhaps to start with Alan and go around.
Thank you. While the Law Society did say, it deliberately said it'd be useful as a confirmation, because I think it's there both in the current law and in what the bill currently says. After all, it starts, the trustees have the power to make any kind of investment of trust property. That's a pretty broad start, and governed by the trustee as a kind of fallback or perhaps possible restriction. So I think it's there anyway, and I think possibly in contrast to some of my colleagues, I think it's already the case that you do not have to maximise financial returns. There can be other benefits from purposes. There is no absolute duty to maximise financial returns. After all, if we could all do that, we would all be marvellous financial advisers. Maximisation is not often the case. Indeed, it might well be the case that maximum investment in what might be described as sin investments like gambling and armaments and tobacco might well have produced much better returns than others over the years. I don't think anybody's suggesting that trustees in particular are driven always to maximise in that way. So I think the power is there anyway. As some of my colleagues were saying earlier, all that might be welcome, if it is a public policy in relation to environmental or climate change driven investments, was thought to be very good public policy, that the trustees should not be exposed to kind of any form of challenge or criticism on the basis of such investments. I personally think that that would be a step too far and is unnecessary, and such a policy would be defensible in most cases anyway within trusts. But as a confirmation, if it is thought to be good public policy, then perhaps this would be a good place to put it.
Okay, because there has been different views, which makes me question whether some clarification or just a kind of explicit line to say that it is perfectly permissible, it is within the powers. Would you agree with that?
Sorry. Well, yes, I can't see a downside to doing that. And the only basis on which I can contribute to this is wearing my hat as a trustee, because I'm a trustee of one or two trusts. And I agree with what Alan says, that I think in practice it does already exist to some extent that trustees regard certain types of investment as not aligning with the nature of the trust of which they are trustees, therefore not appropriate. And, I mean, you've just mentioned gambling and so on. So, for example, and this is not anything that is part of my trusteeship, but if you were a trust for people who had suffered through gambling addiction or similar, you would not expect that the trustees of that trust would invest in betting companies, no matter how high the expectation of gain might be. So I think in practice people are already doing that, and that expectation of financial gain is not the sole consideration. But if it were thought helpful to have some kind of actual clarification that that's permissible, then I can't see a drawback to that. The only, I suppose, counterbalancing point is that you would not want to go so far that the investment decisions reflected the personal values of the trustees. You know, that's probably where your line needs to stop, so that there aren't investment policies about things that the trustees themselves are interested in.
Thank you.
Okay, Sarah Jane.
Yeah, I was actually just going to say the same thing, that as long as it's not the trustees' own personal views that are driving it and it is actually taken from financial advice, and I mean trustees do have the requirement to take advice, then as long as it's what they think is the best for the trust fund, like Alan says, I think that is permitted there already. I think with the sort of ESG type investments at the moment, there's different ways of looking at it. There's a sort of exclusionary view of the I'm not going to invest in gambling, oil, tobacco, that type of thing. But there's a lot of people that take the view that actually it's more of an activist type role, where they want to invest in the sort of bad companies, if you will, and actually try and drive the policy changes within them. So different groups of people have different views on what ESG is. And I think trying to have a blanket approach is really difficult, because actually it's not a one size fits all anyway. And I think it's just, as long as that's what's best for the trust fund, whichever route that takes with ESG, I should say, as Alan says, that it's permissible at the moment. And again, the other thing is, it can be the truster, if they put it into the trust deed at the outset, that this can be done. That sort of overrules what's in the bill to some extent anyway. At the moment, we've got the ability in a trust deed to say trustees can invest in a single investment, which isn't necessarily allowed under the Act. So there's the sort of flexibility there as it stands.
I don't think there's any need to include anything, and I agree with Alan that Section 16.1 is sufficiently broad to allow investment. And we're thinking about a piece of legislation that's going to last perhaps another 100 years, from looking at the 1921 Act. If we start seeing something that looks at policy now, it might look a little odd to our successors in 20, 30, 50 years' time. As Laura said, there is in fact case law about trustees acting out of their own interests in refusing to invest in particular areas. But equally, it's competent and regular, I think, to give instructions to create a policy as to how you wish to invest when you are instructing advisors. And I don't think there's a problem about having ESG attitudes built into your policy and saying no armaments, alcohol and gambling as well. So I think it's happening already, and I don't think there is an issue, and I don't think there's any need to include anything here.
So I think, well, the proposal, as I understood it, was not to instruct, but to have a kind of clarification and for the avoidance of doubt. But it sounds like, are you saying you don't think that would be necessary, or would it be unhelpful if it was in there?
I think it's completely unnecessary, and I don't know how helpful it is, because trustees can establish their own policies. And in my experience, trustees are thinking about these things now.
Thank you.
Laura?
Just to add, you know, listening to Ken, that there is a kind of, again, a general drafting problem that if you've got an apparently unlimited permission to do something and then you go on to say, and you can particularly do the following thing, it necessarily creates uncertainty as to all the stuff that isn't specified. So there's no such thing as a free extra clause. I think, you know, you create ripples. That might be my only reservation, I guess.
I suppose the argument is that because it's such a crucial part of the future life on the planet that that it warrants a specification, but I can see your point. I'll hand back to the convener. Thank you.
Okay, thank you. We'll move on to section 19, and that's the section regarding nominees. And as indicated to the previous panel, that the law firm CMS is concerned that Section 19 of the Bill on Nominees is currently drafted. It may not go far enough. And specifically, the firm has said doubt would remain as to whether trustees can use, first of all, nominee custody structures, and secondly, sub-custodians. Now, what are the panel members' views on both of these aspects, both on the current scope of Section 19 and also the risks identified by CMS? I'll start with Ken.
I think Section 19 is drafted in a satisfactory way. I don't see the particular problem. I must say I hadn't considered sub-custodians, but I don't see there's anything wrong with the drafting.
Okay, thank you. And Sarah Jane?
I think the problem John MacArthur identified earlier is the definition of person. So, I mean, whilst we could say that a corporate has legal personality, perhaps, actually, a trust doesn't have separate legal personality in Scotland. So if your nominee or something like that was a different structure, I think having some form of definition in there would be useful, because while person could be taken to mean potentially a corporate, I don't think it could mean a trust.
Okay, thank you. Laura?
I'm going to defer to my colleagues on this.
Okay.
I think with Ken that it's okay. I think in response to I think a person does include a legal person and therefore does include a corporation. And in response to Sir Jen's point, while a trust, of course, is not a person, trustees are, by definition, person. It's the trustees you appoint, not the trust. There may be kind of nominal gaps in terminology, but I think it is just in terminology. I would certainly think that a person would extend to any delegated agent in legal entity form. But, I mean, if confirmation was thought to be necessary, again, perhaps it won't do any harm. The problem, as indeed Laura has adverted to, if you start to list the things that are, there's a danger of excluding things that it's not and that kind of thing. I'm quite happy with person as it stands. The only thing about the clause more generally is one has to be clear about trustees delegating their powers as trustees. It was adverted to in the earlier session, the difference perhaps between administrative and dispositive powers. And while I think that investment management is a classic example, that most non-specialist trustees are quite rightly not able to carry out their own investment management, therefore not only can but should delegate it to those who are more capable of doing so than them, they must not delegate their, as it were, trustee duties entirely. And I think that as long as that is clear, then the clause as it stands is reasonable.
Sarah Jane?
Yeah, I think there's a distinction between sections 18 and 19. So 19 is the one just relating to the sort of nominees and the delegation to nominees, whereas what Alan was alluding to there is obviously the section 18 delegation to agents. And I do think there needs to be some consideration about what can be delegated in those situations, because under subsection 5 of section 18, there's obviously certain things that are excluded from being delegated, including the decision as to where trust funds should go. But at the start of that section, it says, unless the trustee says otherwise, which would mean a trustor could actually say, actually, trustees can delegate all powers, including the ones excluded under the bill. And in that situation, you could potentially see scenarios where trustees could delegate absolutely every power under their position as trustee. And that seems to go a lot further than what was actually intended, I think, with the bill.
Okay. Okay, thank you for that. Bill Kidd.
Yes, thank you very much, convener. Thank you, panel. looking at section 25 and 26 of the bill, section 25 requires trustees, first of all, to tell a beneficiary that they are a beneficiary, which didn't really surprise me, but there you go. And second, give them all the trustees' names and correspondence details. And this is mandatory for certain types of beneficiary. For potential beneficiaries, trustees have some discretion as to what information is provided under section 25. And section 26 covers the information that must be made available to beneficiaries, and a trustee can override section 26, but a court can later review the reasonableness of that override. So the various correspondents, including the previous panel, have said that trustees' duties to provide information to beneficiaries and potential beneficiaries under these sections of the bill are too onerous. Do you have any ideas about whether these are too onerous, and would you amend the sections to address these concerns at all, please? Anyone who's dead interested in this?
Okay. Well, I go first on this occasion now. Where you've got a fully discretionary trust, you may have, what, three generations specified in that trust of potential beneficiaries. Telling a five-year-old that they're a beneficiary doesn't add particularly to the situation. So I can see it being quite onerous and cascading out quite quickly to a significant number. But I don't know how you control it. It surely is best practice to let potential beneficiaries know that they are potential beneficiaries. But how far do you go when there are long-stop beneficiaries who may never inherit? So I think it's a difficult question to strike any sort of balance with. I think it's good practice to tell beneficiaries, and it's good practice to give information. How much information is always the difficulty to decide, I think.
Okay.
Laura? I just wanted to say that I can actually remember discussion at meetings in the Commission around this, because what I remember was being anxious when I was listening to it, because by that point I already was a trustee of various trusts, and I was thinking, how is this going to impact me and what duties am I going to have? So from that kind of self-interested perspective, I remember the discussion. But I think I would just, I suppose, refer to what the faculty has said about this in its response, that I hear what colleagues are saying about it being good practice, and the faculty has said that it's probably not as alarming as it might seem because of the absence of a sanction. And the final point that the faculty made was the need for publicising of the duty and perhaps providing even, I suppose, guidance, or, you know, certainly something to draw attention to these duties that are going to be imposed on trustees.
For a start, I think it's great that we're getting something, because Scots law has been absolutely lacking in any clear guidance as to what you have to tell, want to tell, need to tell actual or potential beneficiaries. So to have something is an improvement from where we are now. Having said that, I think there are difficulties, there are potential difficulties with it, both small and large. Perhaps I think some of the small are in a written response, and maybe leave them to that. The large is that the potential beneficiary situation. There are many trusts where the potential beneficiaries are the entirety of the world population, because they include anybody nominated by the truster after the trust has been set up. Now, you know, I think there has to be something to discourage fishing expeditions to people who are running trusts to say, am I a potential beneficiary? Well, yes, you are. Yes, everyone in this room is, if the truster chose to nominate them. That, of course, is not a real potential beneficiary. Even in family trusts, there's often very real but unlikely provisions for fallbacks should generations die out. So you go up the family tree and then back down again, where the clear intention, the actual beneficiaries, are immediate family, either across in terms of siblings, spouses and civil partners, or down more commonly in terms of children, grandchildren. So the actual core beneficiaries, if I can invent a term, are very clear, but the potential beneficiary class is necessarily very wide. And I think it will develop, picking up on the potential beneficiary situation, is that that it will not be unreasonable for trustees to refuse to supply information to such people on such phishing informations. I also note there's provision for charging for supplying such information, and I think that's useful too as a discouragement, as I say, to such phishing expeditions. In terms of what I'll call the real core beneficiaries, I think it's, as I say, it's a very good start. One tiny drafting point: in 25.2a, it refers to a beneficiary who has a vested interest in the trust property. And I'm not sure that beneficiaries ever have interest in the trust property as such. The definition of beneficiary later in the Act makes it clear is that they're beneficiaries as against the trustees, as it were, but they don't have rights in the trust property, and perhaps that should be clarified. There's a better property lawyer than me in this panel who I hope will agree with that point.
The only other point on this section that I thought was interesting is there's nothing that's been put in around the duty to account. Now, obviously, trustees' duty to account to beneficiaries is imprescribable under the Prescription Limitation Act, which is a separate piece of legislation. But there's been various case law about what actually needs to be provided to beneficiaries with the accounting, whether any vouching needs to be given or anything like that. And I know in the consultation there was various suggestions that in addition to the accounts, also the vouching behind the accounts would need to be given for a beneficiary to actually be able to meaningfully understand the account effectively and know whether or not there was anything in it that caused them concern. And I think the duty to provide an account, as I say, is an absolute duty. It's just whether or not there's a missed opportunity here for actually clarifying what a trustee does need to give a beneficiary in that sense.
Well, sorry, Alan.
Yeah. Can I just add a couple of other points? Again, it goes to the detail because this is very new law. If the beneficiary is under the age of 16, the duty is to inform their parent or guardian, but it's not made clear, does that change on the 16th birthday? Are you then meant to inform them as well directly? And in some cases, I have absolutely no doubt, parents or guardian don't tell their under 16-year-olds or even their 16-year-olds that they're beneficiaries in trusts. So the trustees might be worried that they don't know at that point. And the second point is a much more general one, in that, as far as I can see, this is retrospective in the sense that it applies to existing trusts. So perhaps it also needs to be made clear, and this may be kind of explanatory notes territory rather than legislative territory, that beneficiaries who are already aware of their rights under existing trusts, the trustees are not obliged to set out when this becomes law to tell all beneficiaries throughout Scotland that they are beneficiaries if they know already.
Okay, thank you. Thank you very much. Can I just ask on the back of that then, the position about section 61 and the alteration of trust purposes in family trusts, because I think that follows on to the back there. And section 61 of the bill gives a power to the beneficiaries and others to apply to the court to alter the trust purposes of a family trust, and it sets out the default position that this power cannot be used for 25 years. Now, you might have heard the previous panel speak somewhat on this. Given the views on the 25-year restriction have been mixed, as I say there, and it's a default power only, are you satisfied that this is the right policy decision to retain the 25-year restriction in the bill? Yep, Sergio.
I think there's a bigger issue there, that is that the truster also has to be dead. So if a truster sets a trust up when they're 25 and they live to 100, you've actually got a period of 75 years. Which actually makes it much longer than the 25. So I think that possibly needs to come out as well.
Well, that's another angle. Right. Thank you very much, Laura.
I just wanted to say, when you listed earlier, you included the Faculty of Advocates as not being in favour of the 25-year period. I suppose I didn't choose the particular wording in the response, but I was actually amused when I saw that we'd said that the imposition of such a lengthy period of 25 years is notable. I think that constitutes the faculty sitting on the fence, actually, which we do try to do about these kind of policy matters. So I'm not going to say too long, too short, whatever. That's a policy point, and there are, you know, there are nearly 500 advocates, and they might all have different views.
Yeah. Okay, well, that's an interesting angle as well. Ken, did you...
I know when we discussed this in our committee that there was an even split on the whether the 25 years was appropriate.
Aye. Yep. There's a differentiation in view, obviously, yeah, but...
Well, no, if there has been a material change, is 25 years too long?
Right.
And is it too easy to call it a material change and therefore bring an action? What is the material change? And I know the previous panel was looking at change in tax regime, which is an obvious one. But it could be a change in a beneficiary situation where they had become incapable and a life rent, for example, had become irrelevant when they'd moved into supported accommodation. So that could happen at any stage. So that would argue for a shorter period. I think it's fairly evenly balanced whether 25 years is appropriate to give effect to the trustor's wishes. I can see it being 10 years is equally appropriate. I think it's a policy issue. I don't think it's a legal issue.
Okay. And yes, Al.
I think the 25 years is way too long because of the other protections, because there has to be a material change. I don't actually see the need for much of a length of period as at all if there is sufficient change and it's under the supervision of the court. On the trustor is dead point, I suspect this might be under some kind of misapprehension in that the point of the trustor being dead is that he or she is no longer in control of the situation, but they weren't anyway. Once they've created their trust, then it may well be that the material change of circumstances occur. They can do nothing about the trust, and it may be thought that they could, but they can't. Therefore, I think that, again, that shouldn't be a relevant consideration to take into account. If there's going to be this power, I think that the shorter the period, the better, because I don't think it will be used frivolously. It'd be expensive to do this. You wouldn't do it for minor things, but it's capable of not just coping with material circumstances changing, but frankly, to some extent, with, oh, I hadn't thought of that, and look, that circumstance has occurred. Please, can we now change it? Which I don't think is a bad thing under the supervision of the court.
Okay. So there is some range of disagreement and agreement. It's wide-ranging sort of thing. And it's something that policy, as you say, rather than lawyers are going to have to sort out. So the lawyers can argue about it later. We can argue about it first. But there you go. Thank you very much indeed. So I've just got the one... personally, the one last thing to talk about, and that is about domicile of the trust, where it is based. And we had in the academics panel Professor Paisley, Professor Gretton, and Yvonne Evans all were pretty much agreed that the protector should not be able to move the permanent residence of a trust outside of Scotland. So on that basis, do you think that the academics were correct in this thought of section 49 of the bill, permitting the protector of a trust to move the domicile outside of Scotland, they said was undesirable in policy terms? Would you agree with that? And if so, what are your views on whether protectors should be allowed to do that or shouldn't? Please. If that makes sense. Yes, sir.
Well, I think it's a broader point. I think that powers to change the domicile, the residence of the trust, by the trustees are commonly included in deeds as drafted. So I don't necessarily think there's a particular point that may have been made about the protector's power to do so. If the trustees can do it under well or at least widely drafted trust deeds, I don't think it adds anything or takes anything away to whether a protector should be able to do this. I don't think it's something specific to the protector side. If
there is a view that, that people should not be able to change the domicile of the trust, despite what the trustee said. That's a much broader thing, and as far as I'm aware, there is nothing in the bill that prevents that happening in terms of the trustee already. So I don't think it is a particular concern in relation to protectors.
Can I just say to Laura Dunlop, please, the Law Society didn't comment on the policy underpinning Section 49. However, it did say that it thought the drafting of the domicile subsection was unclear in terms of its scope, and it thought also that the scope of the separate power of the protector to determine the trust's administrative centre was also unclear. Do you think there needs to be work done in terms of whether that should be allowed to take place, continued, please?
Sorry, I'm not sure. I think that these are the comments of the Law Society. I'm not. Yes.
Oh, right. Beg your pardon. I do apologise, actually. I was misreading that, and I've now had the response from the Law Society anyway. Yeah. Right, but I mean, how would you think, Laura? Do you think that it's something that...
Well, I'm going to... I'm going to pass to Alan to answer, because I think he's got the text of the Law Society's response.
All right.
I think that all's been requested is the clarification of exactly how wide the power is. I mean, is it an absolute power within the protector to just determine, or indeed, going back to my earlier point, perhaps within the trustees, just to determine that the domicile of the trust shall now be Sri Lanka, or whatever they want to say. If that is intended, well, I think that's probably where it is now. I think that protectors, as was said in the earlier panel, are new beasts in the zoo of Scottish trusts. I don't think there's anything to stop them being appointed now. Indeed, I've seen one or two where they have at least been purportedly appointed in Scottish trusts. So I think they exist already. I think the, as it were, sanction provided for them to exist under the Act will encourage their use. Some trusters I can see very much liking this kind of power beyond to somebody else than their trustees. But I think it will develop as to how much, including in the domicile question, the new powers now sanctified by the bill will be used. So kind of watch this space area.
Right. Well, thank you very much for that. Sorry for throwing that at you, Laura.
It's okay.
Anyone else, any comment on... Yes, Sarah Jane, please.
I think I would just add, as Alan said, protectors are relatively new sort of creatures in Scottish trust. It's not something that a lot of people use. But going back to discussions I've sort of had with the sort of Step HQ side of things, one of the things they are looking at is generally making trusts more attractive in the UK and in Scotland, and having protectors there is really useful, particularly if you've got offshore trusts where they are looking at potentially making a Scottish trust and moving the jurisdiction to Scotland. At the moment, there isn't a lot of law around protectors, and so having some clarity and having something for protectors there is really useful. It brings us in line with a lot of the other jurisdictions and will, as Alan says, develop in the future. So I think having something there is good. It's just whether or not this will evolve, essentially, as the law with protectors does in the future.
OK, thank you. Thank you very much indeed for that. I don't know if you want to say anything, Ken. Are you OK?
No, our members had no experience at all of protectors, so we weren't really concerned with this part of the Act at all.
OK, well, that's perfectly understandable. Thank you very much indeed to everyone for that. Thank you.
Thank you. And Mercedes Vialba.
Thank you, Convener. I'd like to move us on to Section 65 and 66, which covers expenses of litigation. So it's been raised with the committee by the Law Society that there's concerns about the current policy underpinning Section 65, which provides principles to determine how legal bills are paid for in trust cases. And the Law Society has said that Section 65 will deter people from becoming trustees and may lead trustees to unfavourably settle or abandon legal proceedings for fear of personal liability. Some of the panel members might have heard our discussion around this with the previous panel. we'd be interested to hear from the other panel members whether they share the concerns that the Law Society has raised with us, or whether you can offer the committee any reassurance. And then for all panel members, we'd be interested to hear whether the availability of insurance might help mitigate against the risks identified by the Law Society. But I don't know if Laura would like to kick us off.
I think I would be pretty brief on this because when I looked at section 65 in preparation for today, I thought it was very carefully drafted, and it seems to be a kind of on the one hand this, on the other hand that, to an extent that almost runs out of hands. And it seemed to me to create the possibility for the court to do pretty much anything about the expenses of a litigation involving a trust. That does not seem inappropriate to me, because the range of practical situations, of factual situations, will be very wide. And speaking as a litigator, I think you can trust the court on matters of expenses. The only other point I would make is that in general terms, I think those of us who have worked in litigation are not particularly enthusiastic about people who can litigate with an absolute guarantee that they are incurring no risk to their own pocket.
Thank you very much.
Anyone else want to come in?
Sarah, would you like to?
I can declare I am not a litigator, so I don't really have a view on the question of expenses.
Alan?
The Law Society who raised it, so I suppose I'd better defend it, but I will defend it. I don't think that the balance is quite as nuanced as Laura has suggested. Notably, in 65.2, what 65.2 is saying is that the trust, to use a non-personal term, has been found liable in expenses. And this, of course, could be in unsuccessfully either pursuing or defending. And the trust has no funds left. And the starting point is that the trustees, jointly and severally, even ones who have been against this, are personally liable. Now, that is fundamentally, I think, unfair. I appreciate that they can go back to court, which is ironic in the circumstances, and ask not to be found liable. Now, this is not the normal case in litigation. If I am unable to recover my expenses in a successful litigation from a company because it lacks resources, or from an individual because they themselves are bankrupt, it doesn't go to any individual director other than extreme circumstances, or some other individual who, because they happen to have personal money of their own. This seems to me to go against the notion of the separate patrimony of a trustee's position. And therefore, I don't think it's appropriate that the starting point in unsuccessful litigation, where the trust fund has run out, should be the different pocket of the trustee as an individual. And if that doesn't stop people in certain circumstances becoming trustees, or at least considering it very carefully, then there's a gap in their understanding of what they might find themselves liable for.
And so, Alan, how would you propose to tackle this? Well, in the bill, if I can put you on the spot.
Yes, I would propose, I can absolutely understand Laura's point that vexatious litigants, you should not be able to go off with the kind of sure and certain knowledge that you will never be personally liable. But I think the court's control over that would be quite sufficient, that they can already deal with that in relation to personal awards. It's the bankrupt trust, that particularly bothers me. And then I think that unless there has been an element of gross negligence, and I appreciate the difference between negligence and gross negligence, in the trustee in prosecuting the action, then the starting point should be no liability for expenses rather than personal liability for expenses. It means a successful litigant doesn't have somebody to recover from, but as I say, that is not uncommonly the case in such circumstances.
Thank you very much. I'll hand back to the convener.
Sorry, could I just come in, Mercedes? Alan mentioned trustees being liable jointly and severally. If they don't like the decision to go ahead with litigation, they can resign office at that stage. I think that's their remedy at that point.
Okay. Sarah Jane?
Of that, that does leave the potential sole trustee holding the bag, who's then going to have to pay for all of the expenses. So I don't think that necessarily solves that problem if everybody else gets their resignation in first. I was going to come back to this later. The resignation clause under Section 5 doesn't require any intimation to the co-trustees either. So on receiving papers saying that a court action has been raised, every trustee could potentially just resign on the same day, and that could cause issues as well. So I don't think that's necessarily the answer. But I agree with Alan that the starting point of having trustees personally liable if there's no funds in the trust seems to go far beyond what we would have anticipated.
Okay. Jeremy?
I mean, one of the questions there was trustee insurance. Would that, if that became mandatory, then would that resolve the issue in regard to individual liability?
I don't think you can insure against every possibility of what could potentially come up as a litigation. So, and if you know that a litigation's coming, I think it was John MacArthur earlier that said where there is pending litigation, your insurance is then less likely for a provider to actually give you it, or if they are going to give you it, the premiums could be so excessive that actually you're not going to be able to pay it out of the trust fund, or it's actually more economical to litigate or to try and settle.
I think insurance is a, to some extent, a bit of a red herring where it is most likely. It's a bit of, we'll offer you an umbrella except if it's going to rain, because that is often the case when it is most wanted. I think making it compulsory trustee insurance is a very big and interesting separate point, that should trustees be insured in their capacity as trustees, as opposed to perhaps some other professional insurance that fortunately many of us have, but is a separate point, I think, from the litigation point and the expenses in litigation point.
My experience of trustee insurance is it tends to be called an errors and omissions policy. It doesn't necessarily cover you for positive acts where you make a decision to do something.
I just wanted to say that I don't envy you, because this is one of these situations where you're choosing between two deserving parties. You know, you've got the person who's sued the trust and who's been successful and normally therefore would be recovering expenses, but then you've also got the trust that's run out of funds. And these are always difficult situations. I think in support of my earlier comments that the section seems to me to be quite flexible, there is also subsection 6 about the court being able to relieve a trustee for personal liability. So, you know, in the types of situation that are being described, then one would imagine that that jurisdiction of the court would be invoked.
Sarah Jane?
I think just one other point to mention in relation to this is there is in law generally a sort of move towards alternative dispute resolutions like mediation and things like that. And there isn't really anything in the bill that suggests mediation as a method of actually resolving it before it goes to court or anything like that. I know mediation is a separate policy and all the rest of it, but it was just whether or not that was also a missed opportunity for considering something else before going to court. Because again, if it's going to be a scenario where actually the trust fund's going to be depleted and someone who would otherwise be successful, perhaps going to something like mediation or arbitration in advance and actually dealing with it in another way so that expenses and things like that can be dealt with outside of court might be useful.
Okay. Thank you.
Thank you. I mean, I think just picking up that final point, I think we did raise that with the Law Commission when we took evidence a couple of weeks ago, and they were slightly sceptical of the concept, but I think it's worth maybe having a look at again. If I can just move us on quickly to section 67 of the bill, and the Faculty of Advocates and others have said that they think the power in this section of the bill to give directions to the court needs to be a much wider than the power which currently appears in the bill. And I'm just wondering if the other panel members would like to comment on that and then perhaps ask Laura to defend the position at the end.
Our committee would be with the Faculty of Advocates in that. I think that a wider power to seek directions with the dangers and expenses is not a bad thing to have. And I think that this is quite narrow, or at least could be interpreted quite narrowly. So I would be in favour of a broader power to seek directions.
Alan said. I think broader is not a bad thing in this scenario.
A broader power wouldn't do any harm, let's put it that way. It can only do good. Subject, as Alan says, to expenses.
Excellent. Almost consensus. Thank you.
And Mercedes.
Thanks, Convener. If I could move us to part two of the bill, to section 72 on the right of a spouse or civil partner to inherit. We had a discussion about this with the previous panel as well. So various stakeholders, including the Law Society, have said that a distinction should be drawn between spouses or civil partners who were living with the deceased person at the time of their death and spouses or civil partners who had previously separated from the deceased person but hadn't actually divorced or had the partnership dissolved. So the committee is interested to hear from other members of the panel what you think of this policy idea, whether you agree with it, and whether you think it's possible with good drafting of the provision to describe what is separation and what isn't separation. And it would also be helpful then if Alan, if you'd like to come in and if you want to add any points of clarification on the Law Society's submission to us. Thank you.
Look at the 64 Act, the Succession Scotland Act 1964. The rights of succession in Section 2 will only apply after prior rights in Sections 8 and 9 and legal rights have kicked in, which are common law. So under Section 8 of the Act, a spouse or civil partner will get an interest in a dwelling house up to £473,000, provided they were resident in the property that they're claiming. They will also get a cash entitlement of either 58 or 75,000, depending on whether or not there are children, and they'll get the plenishings in the house as well. So this section only operates after that, and the house would pass on the basis of whether or not they survived, whether or not they were resident. Then we've got legal rights kicking in, which would be one third or one half of the movable estate, depending on whether there are children or not. So this is a long stop provision that comes in after these other provisions take effect. And my view is we don't need any definition of cohabitation inserted into what is Section 72.
Okay, Sarah Jane.
I think this is one of those things that was discussed earlier, which is essentially there's one little bit of succession law that has been tacked on to the end of what is a trust bill. And with succession law, there's been various consultations, the last one in 2019, looking at various things around the rights of cohabitants, legal rights, things like that. And after the last consultation, there was a couple of bits they said they were going to legislate on, this point being one, just to bring it in line with, obviously, public policy. But I think if we're going to start looking at what the rights of cohabitants should be and go further, what effectively the consultation said before was that they were going to do further investigation, further consultation before legislating on it. And I think to try and do that as part of a trust bill would delay the trust bill from moving forward. And I think I speak for the STEP committee when I say we're all very keen to get the trust bill, given we're already over 100 years since the last substantive law change on it. So from my point of view, looking at that side of things, I think the driver here would be getting the trust bill moved forward. And if anything more is to be done on succession law, that would hopefully be a separate bill or a separate act on its own, and further consultation and views would be taken on that, rather than looking at it as part of a trust bill.
Okay, thank you. Laura?
I think I'd just make a couple of comments on both form and substance. I've seen a lot of proposed reforms over the years where something that's quite simple and straightforward is put in quite early in the process, and then people say, oh, well, let's wait till we're doing a much bigger piece of reform and do it all then. And what happens is that the straightforward and simple things that you could do now get lost sight of and don't come in for years. So on the hypothesis that this has been included because it was thought to be a fairly straightforward consensual change that could be made now, and it's not an inappropriate vehicle in which to do it, I don't take any issue with this being included. The substance of it, however, having read previous comments at previous sessions and listened today, I think I would recognise the merit in having an exception for people who are separated. And I am with George Gretton and others who said that capturing that in a statutory definition is possible. I mean, actually, the conversation that was taking place earlier today in the previous panel, if you were to suggest that the touchstone of a separated couple would be people who have a separation agreement, that actually would be a form of definition. I mean, I wouldn't favour that, and I think that Sandy Lam gave very good practical reasons why that's far too high a touchstone. But I'm an optimist. I think some workable definition could be found.
Thank you.
Alan?
Yes, I tend to agree that it would be better if succession was returned to more substantially, because there's still a lot, of course, about the general law of intestate succession, the balance between spouses, civil partners, indeed cohabitants on the one hand, and children have to be sorted out. But I also agree with what Laura has said. If there's a relatively simple change that can happen quickly and it appears to have wide public support, then let's do it. And we may come back to that in the final part of this session. So I am in favour of it, but very definitely with the safeguard of some kind of living together. Now, I don't think this is as difficult as people have suggested. In tax law, my other part of my day job, the concept of a couple living together as husband and wife and receiving certain tax treatment there has existed for many, many years and is dealt with. Picking up on examples that have been given, to my pretty certain knowledge, it has never caused a problem with the couple who are separated because one is living in a care home. In the earlier panel session, Mr. Balfour's submariner would not have been considered to be separated from his or her spouse or civil partner by means of being necessarily away for that period. So I do not think it is beyond the wit of a draftsperson to come up with a wording that covers separation other than separation because they've intended to get separated. I certainly wouldn't go with a separation agreement as being the trigger, because this is the couples affected are exactly the kind they want to have a separation agreement because they've not got around to dealing with a will to start with things. I mean, this is great news for lawyers in a way. It just adds emphasis to the when people separate, for goodness sake, make a new will is really crucial in these circumstances. But people don't. People won't. We still have a majority of people who don't make wills. So intestacy is really important here. I think it can also, this has been put to me, well, really the dealing with rights of separated spouses is a matter of family law, not succession law. This can only deal with succession law. In terms of the separated spouse, unless there's some qualification, what intestacy is meant to do, I think, is to represent what the deceased would have done if they had thought about it. Now, in most cases, 100% to your continuing spouse or civil partner meets that definition perfectly. Where, however, there has been separation, it's a reasonable bet that if this came in the force it was for the separated spouse, intestacy would bring the result least on earth that the deceased person would have wanted. The very last person they would want to inherit would inherit. So I think that some attempt at a definition of when spouses are still, or civil partners, are still in that, as it were, almost spiritual state to extend that, it should be included. And I don't think it's that hard to do.
Sarah Jane?
Thank you. I'll maybe just say, as the convener said to the previous panel, if any panellists have suggestions or ideas or thoughts they'd like to follow up with the committee, we'd be very grateful to receive them, I think.
So Sarah Jane?
I was just going to say, in terms of what Laura said, I agree that actually just putting the one little bit on at the end of this makes sense, just to get it done, since it was one of the bits from the last consultation that was agreed on. The point I was making is that in terms of broader rights of cohabitants and things like that, I think should be separate. I think in terms of when people are separated, again, as Alan said, having a separation agreement is not necessarily a good definition in the sense that not everyone will go and do it. But also, if someone has started a separation agreement but not signed it at the time of death, it can cause issues around whether or not they did intend to complete it, or were they actually intending, or was the reason it was stopped or not finished because they were actually considering reconciliation, because that can also happen in various situations and things like that. So actually a more practical definition. And I think someone mentioned it earlier, Sandy Lamb, I believe, mentioned the marriage by cohabitation and repute sort of scenario of looking at whether or not parties were known as being in a relationship. So regardless of whether they are living together or not, because again, you might have parties who were married and have moved apart and are living separately, but actually they are still known as being a married couple or in a civil partnership or whatever their relationship status is. So I think a more practical view would need to be taken.
Thank you. And the final question is on, once again, part two of the bill, and it's, as you'll have heard from the previous session, that the committee has had some suggestions of three policy proposals which could actually be added to part two of the bill to assist it. First of all, the creating exceptions of legal rights as they currently apply to protect from disinheritance. That was from Professor Paisley. Secondly, the amending the current strict six-month time limit, which applies in the context of the cohabitant's power to apply to the court for a share of the deceased's estate. That was from the Faculty of Advocates and Yvonne Evans. And thirdly, the clarifying of the law does not permit an unlawful killer to be an executor of the victim's estate. That was from Professors Paisley and Gretton. So we're keen to hear your views on those three points. Start yourself first, Alan.
No, yes and yes, I think this would be the answer. In the legal rights, I think, and the possible restriction on them is part of this big, broad, unfinished succession work. And I think to try and tack something into this, a little unlike the thing we've just been talking about, would be wrong. The other two fit perfectly into that. I think there'd be no objection to getting rid of unlawful killers as executors, and it would be a quick and short win, I think. And the only difficulty about the extension of cohabitants' rights to claim under Section 29 is possibly the period involved, in that it's been suggested, I think, 6 months should be 12 months. Well, that solves many of the problems, perhaps in practice, but not in principle, in that executors can delay getting themselves appointed if this is thought. So there is perhaps more thought required on that one. But certainly the third one on unlawful killer executors, I think, could be a thing that is readily tacked in here. We won't often get the opportunity, so let's do it.
Thank you. Laura?
On the first one, legal rights, I absolutely agree with what Alan has said. There is much work to be done in the wider area of succession law, and in earlier consultations going back several years, I have taken part in writing the faculty's response in two of them, and it was a lot of work. So there's still unfinished business, and I think the whole legal rights question belongs in that project whenever it comes along. I do recognise that succession law is a particularly, perhaps uniquely difficult area in which to reform. I went to an excellent event about consultation in Glasgow University Law School pre-pandemic, and one of the obvious points that was made is that succession law is an area where the entire population are the stakeholders. So it's extremely difficult to consult the people who are affected, you know, in any straightforward way. I don't have any answers to that, but I think it's probably worth acknowledging. Much shorter in relation to issues two and three, the question of the appointment of an executor who has been in some way responsible for the death of the person. I looked at the response that the faculty wrote on that very topic in 2019. We sent a response to a consultation, and our answers to questions 20 to 25 were on this topic, and I would simply adopt and repeat what we said then. We haven't, I think, changed our position on that at all. and I can copy that in further correspondence if that makes it more straightforward. In relation to Section 29 of the 2006 Act, we have covered that in our current response to the current bill, and I don't have anything to add to what was said in writing.
Okay, that's okay. Thank you. Sarah Jane.
On the Section 29 limit, I think in terms of extending it, instead of it being from date of death, I wonder if it's just a time limit from date confirmation's obtained, so that that then means that it can't be done until confirmation. The time limit won't start until confirmation has at least granted, and at least at that point in time, a time limit would start then. So if it was 6 months from confirmation rather than 6 months from date of death, it extends it a little bit. And then you won't have the executors delaying in their actions necessarily, because it's just delaying the time limit. On legal rights, I just reiterate what's been said already. I think that's part of a larger consultation. But in terms of the unlawful killers, my view was that the removal of trustees under this would also apply to executors, actually. So there was provisions there for removing trustees who are convicted of an offence, imprisoned on conviction of an offence, imprisoned for contempt of court or for not having paid a fine. So there is provisions there for removal of trustees of an offence, which would include an unlawful killing. That's either by co-trustees or by a beneficiary with a vested interest, I believe.
Okay.
The only question on that is whether we would also want to extend it to cover any other offences. I think that was discussed in previous panels, and the only one I had considered was or in discussions with other colleagues in relation to people who have been struck off their register of their relevant profession. So for solicitors struck off from the Law Society or accountants who have been struck off from their profession. Because if they're appointed in a professional capacity and there is a higher bar for professional trustees, whether or not there should be similar provision for removing them.
Okay, thank you. And finally, Ken.
Okay, on unlawful killing, I don't see any difficulty in removing the executor. I think that's a sensible reform to adopt. The only slight caveat is you can get into a situation where the person confirms to the estate you're not aware that they are the killer at that stage, and they only become the executor could be complete before any charges are brought. I'm simply saying that from that possibility does exist. On legal rights, it's a huge policy issue as to what you're trying to do with the law of succession. Do you give people fixed shares, which we've had for hundreds of years? People have an expectation then that they will get something out of the estate as a result of legal rights. So you've got to change public perceptions if you're going to change the law as well. What is the purpose of legal rights? Is it to allow some of the estate to pass down generations, some of the family wealth to pass down generations? Or is it something where there is a principle that people who have need should get more? If you start looking at need, you start looking at discretionary remedies, you start looking at court actions, which slows down executories, increases the expense. So there are very difficult policy choices. And I note when the Commission looked at it in its report in 2009 on succession, it came up with two different schemes, option A and option B, because the Commission could not reach a single view on it either. So I think it is quite a difficult thing. It's not something to embark on in a bill that's already in process. On Section 29, I think it's well known that Section 29 is poorly drafted in a number of ways. It's perfectly acceptable to increase the time limit. Sarah Jane makes the point about confirmation, although a number of estates will pass without there being confirmation granted. So you're not doing anything with the time limit for those cases, and smaller estates will certainly be in that situation. The principal difficulty is that the court is given a vast array of things to take into account in reaching its decision, but it's not given any guidance as to what it's giving money for. Is it right or is it future dependence? The tendency in the court decisions is towards future dependence. And if we look at the Law Commission's report in 2009, when they suggested a redraft of the provisions of Section 29, I've noted here paragraph 4.10, a cohabitant has to earn her right to a share of an intestate estate, which seems to me entirely inappropriate language to use, and suggest you look at the length and you look at the interdependence of financial and other relations and the contribution to the household, which is a very, very old-fashioned way, it seems to me, of looking at cohabitation. So I don't think that sort of formulaic approach resolves matters, and I think the approach that the courts have adopted in terms of Section 29 is preferable, that it's a future needs-based formula.
Okay, no, thank you for that. So, so with that, I'd like to thank the panel for your helpful evidence today. The committee may follow up by letter with any further points or that or questions that are stemming from today's evidence. But also, if there are any points that you would like to highlight to the committee that they haven't come up today, if you could please do so in writing. I think we'd greatly appreciate that. So with that, this concludes the public part of the meeting, and I'll move the committee into private.